Welcome to the Alex Jones Show today. I'm going to be your host, David Knight, on this day before tax day. Of course, Hillary Clinton has some plans for you for income taxes if she becomes president. We've had Bernie Sanders talking about Ronald Reagan had a tax rate of over 90%. And of course, the standard for whether or not we should do something, folks, is not whether or not Ronald Reagan did it. Okay, it's the Constitution, and then does this work even? We could also take a look at that. And it's an outright lie to say that that was Reagan's tax rate. That was what made Reagan a Republican, when it was a 90% tax rate and he was highly paid individual working in Hollywood. He thought that was unjust. He said, hey, people are just going to stop working. It's essentially a Ayn Rand moment that he had. Became a Republican, ran for president, and when he became president, he lowered those taxes to just two rates, and they were very low rates. Down in the 20% rate was the top rate. Now, after George H.W. Bush got in, he called that, remember, voodoo economics, and kept telling everybody, no, 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 read my lips, I won't raise your taxes. And then that was the first thing he did. He gave us the biggest tax increase we had ever had, George the First. And when reporters questioned him on that, I'll never forget, he was out jogging, and he just looked at the reporters and he said, read my hips, and jogged off. And it's like, what a cynical liar. And of course, we now have one of his proteges there. We have a guy from inside the Bush administration, Ted Cruz, who is running for president. He is seeking Wall Street donors openly. He was being criticized by the insiders, by Wall Street, by the National Review, just a couple of months ago, saying he's calling us neocons. That's a pejorative term. He's using it like a dog whistle. Now, all those people that he was labeling neocons are his foreign policy advisors. So we're going to be talking today. We've got a lot of interviews. We're going to have Arthur Thompson of the John Birch Society. He's going to be in, talk to us about Ted Cruz's connections to the Council on Foreign Relations, to the North American Union, namely his wife, Heidi Cruz. So he's going to be joining us. We're also going to be talking to Brian Toohey. He's America's leading expert on game fixing in sports, because you know what? The elections are really like a game, aren't they? It's like rigging a sporting event, especially the more it becomes electronic. We got another article we're going to talk about today. Here's the headline. Man accidentally deletes his entire company with one line of bad code. When I first looked at that, I saw country, because so many different ways we can just get rid of the entire country. You know, we can have computer programs that bomb all the time. Let's have our autonomous killer drones start bombing the country with some bad code. Of course, that could also be a false flag. Or let's just, instead of the computer crashing, let's actually have the computer crash with us inside of it. That's called a self-driving car. We should be concerned about how much we turn over to the virtual reality world, to the computer world. And I say this as somebody who worked in that field for a very, very long time as an engineer, as a programmer. I don't trust computers. I don't trust the government. And we need to have checks and controls on both of them. And when I see the two of them combining, it gives me the heebie-jeebies. We're also going to take a look at the charges being dropped against Donald Trump's campaign manager. And this isn't just about the inside politics of this. It tells us a lot about the people on both sides of this. And I think we need to really understand these people like Megyn Kelly, Michelle Fields, people that Megyn Kelly has sub for her sometimes, like Dana Loesch. We need to start calling them something. I don't know. We've got neocons. Maybe we could call them neo-fems, you know, these tough power women who try to trump up these charges. We're going to talk to you about exactly what they're coming out and saying. We've also got the head of the UN, the UN Secretary General, saying, I'm glad that Obama is ignoring Congress on global warming. No, no, no. Congress is with him on this. You have to understand, they're just telling that to the Republican voters. As soon as he passed the climate change treaty in Paris, it was 3 days until Paul Ryan completely funded his climate change agenda. And he's not going to have any opposition to that in the Supreme Court with Justice Scalia gone. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
It was George Berkeley that famously said, if a tree falls in the forest and no one is there to hear it make a sound, did it make a sound? Well, I'm here to give you the answer to that age-old question. Yes, it did. if the American Republic had fallen and no one in the mainstream media told you, would the Republic still be dead? And the answer is yes. In 20 plus years on air, I've never seen a demarcation line that clearly shows to me the full collapse has basically already gone to a point where you can say this country is unrecognizable and we are rapidly accelerating into a nightmare totalitarian system. We've seen Priebus, the head of the Republican Party. We've seen the head of the Rules Committee, Curly Hewlin or whatever his name is, come out and openly say, listen, the media's wrong. You never had a vote. It doesn't count. The party picks whoever's there. You're just here at a fashion contest.
Political parties choose their nominee, not the general public, contrary to popular belief.
Then why bother holding the primaries?
That's a very good question.
Then when myself and Roger Stone and others came out and simply called for people to go protest and demonstrate and talk to the delegates, and we said, and don't be violent, in Cleveland coming up in a few months, they had all their pundits go on TV and say, maybe Roger Stone should be arrested. This is in a climate with all these incredible attacks on free speech, and it's really creepy.
We are a free society in America. We're not a third world country. We don't threaten violence against delegates, and I think that Reince Priebus and the RNC should move to ban Roger Stone from the convention, because we cannot tolerate threats and threats of violence.
They're also stealing states and delegates from Bernie Sanders. Ladies and gentlemen, they're telling you that they're allowed to make these rules, but they're taking public taxpayer money by the billions, and the counties and cities are holding out that we're having public elections where it's one person, one vote. There are federal and state election laws, like the 1965 Voting Rights Act, that's meant to block this type of racketeering. Even Jim Crow laws against poor blacks and whites were not this strict or this over the top. And I'll close with the words of President JFK. Those that make peaceful revolution impossible make violent revolution inevitable. And the power brokers know that, and they want to break our will and push forward and want a civil war in this country. Let's peacefully go out. Let's sue these people. Let's donate to political causes. Let's get involved. Let's have our minds heard. Let's expose these political party machines. Let's do everything we can to stop this illegal, criminal takeover of America by a two-party system establishing an oligarchy or dictatorship in this country. As George Carlin said, it's a big club and you ain't in it.
Welcome to the Alex Jones Show today. I'm David Knight, your host on this Thursday, April 14th, the day before tax day. And as I mentioned in the last segment, Hillary Clinton is going to raise your taxes by a lot. We have a story up on Infowars.com pointing out exactly where she wants to raise your taxes. She's got a slew of new tax hikes, including a 28% cap on itemized deductions to raise $350 billion for college subsidies. So that's what you do. You penalize one group and you hand it out to another group, which will vote for you. As H.L. Mencken said, an election is nothing but an advanced auction of stolen goods. I think that was Mencken. It might have been Mark Twain. They both understood exactly what elections are about. So she plans to bring in another $275 billion for infrastructure purposes. So where's she going to get that? Well, we're either going to borrow it or we're going to tax it. And of course, we just had a government official saying we're going to soon have a debt that is larger than our GMP is able to service. But that's no problem. We can just keep handing out these benefits and we can keep increasing the taxes, you know, because you can always just work harder, as Jeb Bush said. We also have the UN Secretary General saying, I'm glad Obama is ignoring Congress on global warming. Another story that's up on Infowars.com. Listen to what he had to say. This is the UN Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon. He says, unfortunately, I am concerned, he tells the Wall Street Journal. He says, I'm concerned about Republican opposition to the UN's Paris Treaty. But I do appreciate President Obama's strong commitment, he said. He knew that with all this opposition to the Republican Party's stance, he may not be able to have all of this legally through a legal process. This is the chair of the UN saying this. He says, you know, I really appreciate that Obama's going to do this. He knows that he may not be able to do this legally through a legal process. And then he goes on to say this, but he also has executive power. He will do whatever he can under his executive power. Let that sink in for a little bit. You got the president of the UN saying, well, he's got opposition by the democratically elected Congress. to what he's doing. He doesn't have the ability to do this through a legal process, but I trust that he will do this anyway, using his executive power. See, even a foreigner knows that what is happening with the executive orders isn't legal. And it's a subversion of our rule of law. But that doesn't matter, because even the Republicans don't really care what the rule of law is. You know, we make the rules. We are the rulers and we make the rules. The word, the law is in our mouth, okay, in our dictates. That's what a dictator is. And so we're seeing dictates from the Republican Party when it comes to the election. We're seeing dictates from Obama. They all want to do this. Listen, we've said many times, the reason the Republicans don't impeach him for his unconstitutional use of executive power is because they're exactly like him. They just have different things that they want to do. Or maybe they don't have different things they want to do. Because when you look at this climate change situation, as soon as it was passed on a weekend. And you had Republican senators, one of them specifically said, well, we're going to have something to say about that. In other words, it's not going to happen. Well, actually, he didn't say it wasn't going to happen. He just said, we're going to have something to say about it. And quite frankly, it didn't take them but 3 days to have something to say about it. And they said, you're approved. They passed and completely funded the Paris Climate Change Accord within 3 days. They did the omnibus bill that Paul Ryan ran through, which basically removed all of their leverage. The newly appointed majority, they didn't have any leverage. They ran all this stuff through to make sure that even before the Republicans had a majority, before the new blood got in, that would say, wait a minute, we were just elected to do the opposite. No, they fully funded Obama, and they fully funded his climate change agenda, so he doesn't have to do that. The only obstacle that he really ran into was the Supreme Court, of course, because Obama said before he was running the first time, he said he was going to shut down the coal industry, and he is using the EPA as his means to do that. The EPA, with his war on coal, they could basically shut the coal industry down, had 28 states suing this legislation in the courts, and it was going to be heard in the D.C. Court, the federal court in D.C., three judges there. They knew they were going to lose with those three judges, but they knew they were going to win when it got appealed to the Supreme Court, because Scalia was going to be the fifth vote. With Scalia out of the picture now, it will be 4-4 when it goes to the Supreme Court, so the lower court decision will stand. And guess what? The guy that he wants to appoint to the Supreme Court is going to be the deciding vote at the lower court. So that's the way this whole thing works. We have a single party at the top, and they have a single agenda. And let me tell you, the reason that they're so upset with Donald Trump, and we've mentioned this many times, is because he opposes that agenda on the climate change treaty, on the trade treaties, on the open borders. Those are the three ways that they're going to destroy this country and erect their new world order, their consolidation. Now, we've got some interesting guests that are coming up today. Arthur Thompson is going to be coming in. He's the head of the John Birch Society. He's going to be joining us live in studio in the second hour. We're going to talk specifically about that. We're going to talk about Heidi Cruz, the first lady of the North American Union. See, you need to understand the background of the Cruises. You need to understand their long background with the Council on Foreign Relations, with Goldman Sachs, with the Bush administration. You need to understand that he's been there as a beard, as a Trojan horse. And so we're going to talk to Arthur Thompson from the John Birch Society. In the second hour, we're also going to be talking to Brian Toohey. He is an expert on sports games and how they can be fixed, because what we have here in this election truly is analogous to a sports game, especially the more we use electronics to run our voting and to get involved with that. We also have Portland Students for Trump. Remember earlier this week, we had some a report of some students in a Portland university who wanted to start to organize in favor of Trump. It's a very small number of students, and they were hit by a mob that basically shut down their free speech. Our reporters are going to be there for that meeting when they have it this weekend, and they're going to be heading to Portland, Oregon. They're in New York right now, and we're going to be talking to them also in the show. We have Rob Dew. Joe Biggs are going to be in New York City. They're going to join us briefly during the first 3 hours, and then they're going to be with us in the fourth hour. They're also going to be going to, as I said, Portland and to Chicago. And Donald Trump is highlighting the big protest that's going to be happening in Colorado tomorrow. We've got a lot of people upset about what happened in Colorado. I think rightfully so. That election was shut down. It was stolen. They said, well, these are rules that were put in place last summer. And Donald Trump tweeted out and he says, well, the rules did change in Colorado shortly after I entered the race in June because the politicians and their bosses knew I would win with the voters. See, the problem is whether it's Trump or whether it's Sanders or whether it's somebody else, they don't want somebody who is outside of their inner club. And the New York Times even talked about that. They said, well, you know, voters are feeling like they're left out. Poor things. But they need to understand these are just private parties. And the rules are designed to keep people like Trump and Sanders out of the nomination. They're just doing what they were designed to do. Now, what you need to understand is that these are corrupt racketeering organizations. They truly are mafia. I think it's interesting that Ted Cruz would go on with Glenn Beck and talk about Donald Trump as if he's mafia, when really the true mafia is the GOP and the Democrat National Committee as well. The DNC, the RNC, they have been given monopoly powers, this duopoly. I guess you could call it a monopoly because this time around, they're all looking for the same thing. As I mentioned, they want those three policies to go through. They want the open borders. They want the trade treaties. They want the climate treaty to go through. That will allow them to control our countries, to take down our sovereign countries. That's what they have to have happen, and they want a candidate that's going to do that. That's why they're blocking both Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump. Even Bernie Sanders is a little bit of an obstacle to that. He's with them on two of those three issues, but on one of those, he could be a bit of a speed bump. Donald Trump, however, has been opposing them on all three of those issues for 30 years. Now, he goes on to say this. Donald Trump tweeted out the big protest march in Colorado on Friday afternoon. Don't let the bosses take your vote. And don't fail to be there if you can. We're going to be there. We're going to be there with our reporters. They're going to be covering what's happening. There's going to be a protest at the, I think it's at the GOP headquarters in I guess it's Denver, Colorado. We need to make our voice heard. Now, of course, when we do that, we have Glenn Beck and others call us terrorists. Let's play this clip of Ted Cruz with Glenn Beck.
They're already starting to give out the home addresses of people that were delegates.
Yes. You know, Glenn, I'm very troubled by this. Donald Trump now has a consistent pattern of inciting violence. Donald and his henchmen pushing for violence. You know, you go back to his rallies when a protester shows up and Donald.
Okay, let's pause it right there. Donald and his henchmen. You see, Ted Cruz can go to Wisconsin and he can twist the arms of the delegates there. He can lobby them. He can do whatever he wants to. And that's just fair game. That's just politics. But if you want to talk to the GOP, you better shut up or we're going to call you a henchman. We're going to call you a violent mob. That's what they're doing here. Because, see, you're not a stakeholder. You don't get a right to say things like that. You can't talk like that. You know, and when I look at them calling us violent, I remember what Glenn Beck did at the Bundy Ranch standoff when he called the people there who were peacefully standing up to the violence from the BLM. And the BLM had been violent. They had shut down people's First Amendment. They said, this is a First Amendment area, blocked off this little tiny square out in the middle of nowhere. Doing all of that, neighbors said, you're not going to do that here. They stood with each other. They legally carried sidearms, okay? They didn't threaten or assault the feds in spite of this indictment. And you had Glenn Beck calling them terrorists, calling them violent terrorists, along with David Barton saying, this is nothing at all like the Tea Party. No, the Tea Party was far more violent. The Tea Party destroyed things. These people didn't. And I am sick and tired of Glenn Beck labeling people this. We've had someone killed now because of the kind of labeling that Glenn Beck has done.
We are witnessing an unprecedented coming out of the closet by tyrants. Barack Obama represents the top five megabanks and the Fortune 100 that are owned and controlled by this group. They are establishing an open world government where they are above the law. But at the domestic level, they want dictators or communist or fascist systems to control the population, to extract the wealth to the offshore combines that, again, are above the law tax-exempt, and have diplomatic and regulatory immunity. That's what President Obama was talking about a few weeks ago when he traveled to Argentina to say there's not much difference between capitalism and communism.
In the past, there's been a sharp division between left and right, between capitalist and communist or socialist. And especially in the Americas, that's been a big debate, right? You're a capitalist Yankee dog. And I think for your generation, you should be practical and just choose from what works.
The controlled corporate media no longer criticizes Cuba and its massive human rights violations, or China's intensifying violations, killing Buddhists and Falun Gong, peaceful people who weren't even protesting, and selling their organs that are chopped out of their bodies in mobile execution vans. 10 years ago, our government did criticize it. No more. And it's because our system is going totalitarian. This is the fall of America that we're witnessing right now. And that's why it's more important than ever that you use your First Amendment or lose it. InfoWars is the tip of the spear. Go to InfoWars.com/newsletter. Sign up for our InfoWars Insider so we can get past the censors and send you critical videos, articles, and other intel. There are so many ways for you to support InfoWars.com and get these critical articles and information out. We're already growing exponentially, but we need to turbocharge and go to the next level. Every day, sign off on your email, your Facebook, your Twitter with InfoWars.com/show. Send people the free podcast list. Send people the free iPhone and Android apps that are at InfoWars.com/show. People are ready to hear the truth. Visit InfoWarsStore.com to find thousands of items, the highest quality, the lowest prices on nutraceuticals and supplements, on shortwave radios, on non-GMO heirloom seeds, on powerful Second Amendment t-shirts, ball caps, Hillary for prison apparel, you name it. Now is the time to practice the First Amendment or lose it. Now, they're trying to take our right to vote away, but we also have the right of the free market voting with our dollars. And we can still change things by supporting institutions and organizations that tell the truth and support and promote basic free market Renaissance Americana values. That's why when you spend your money at InfoWarsStore.com and when you spread the word about the broadcast to everyone you know, you are an active participant in the second American revolution against the tyrants that have come in and occupied this nation. For all of you that have supported us, I want to thank you and ask you to increase your efforts. For those that have been on the fence but know this country's in trouble, I know I'm not perfect. Nobody is. But InfoWars has been the most effective and has got the best shot at really awakening the sleeping giant. So join us today. Support the InfoWar and be part of the solution.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host on this day before tax day. We're reminded in another article that many U.S. corporations paid little in federal income taxes. And I remember it was just last week we had Bernie Sanders go after the CEO of General Electric, Jeffrey Immelt. And I thought that's an interesting target because Jeffrey Immelt is so deeply connected to the Obama administration. I mean, he's the first person they go to and pull in. And of course, it's a corporation that pays absolutely no taxes. When we look at Hillary Clinton's proposals on how she's going to raise taxes to pay for all of her new welfare programs, and the college tuition is the one that's at the top of the list. When we look at that, oh, these are going to be corporate taxes. These are going to be taxes on the super rich that we're going to be putting on. It's like, look, understand, those people don't pay any taxes. Okay? They have the tax code written for them. It's the whole thing is a bait and switch. It's all smoke and mirrors. They put these laws in there, and then at the same time, they put the fine print loopholes down there that they know about, that they had written in there to get them out. It's just for your consumption. You are going to be paying the taxes, especially the people who are just working with a job. You're going to pay the bulk of these taxes. They're going to be robbing you and then giving some of that money back to you if they don't pass it out to your neighbor and if they don't keep it in their sticky fingers. Before we get back to the news, I want to just let you know about a special that we've got now, an unprecedented special on BrainForce. It is my favorite product that we have here at InfoWarsLife.com. Get BrainForce right now at 45% off of retail. It's an additional 25% off the sale price that is on our website there. That's a total of 45% off BrainForce. And as I said before, if I had tried it and they'd asked me, I would have called it Brain Focus, because that's what it does for you. BrainForce uses natural brain activation ingredients like yerba mate extract and alpha GPC. Some of these ingredients that we have in BrainForce are prescription ingredients in Europe. This is really good stuff. If you haven't tried this, take a look at the hundreds of five-star reviews that you can read for yourself, along with our other products. We do that for all of our products. We have a spot there where people who use them can talk about the products. Take a look at the reviews on our InfoWarsLife.com site. Remember, 25% off the already sale price. That's a total of 45% off BrainForce right now at InfoWarsLife.com. Going back to the election, an interesting development here today. We had Donald Trump's campaign manager, Corey Lewandowski, will not be charged for assault. And, of course, you could look at that video. We had people like Bill Maher, who's not a Trump supporter. We had Piers Morgan, who looked at that video. You could look at it yourself. You can see that there is no assault going on there. And you can also go back and look at her original charges and see how inflated and ridiculous those charges were. We also said that, pointed out that the guy who had brought the indictment was somebody who was an ardent Hillary Clinton supporter. Now, that has been dropped, and it was inevitable that that was going to be dropped. But what is surprising is that these people don't stop. And I think we ought to start calling Megyn Kelly the lead of the neo-fems. You know, you got the neocons, and of course, she's a neocon as well. She loves all the conservative wars everywhere all the time. But I think a neo-fem is maybe a good term for them, because, you know, these are the tough, tough power women until they get in a press scrum like Michelle Fields, and then it's like, Ma, he touched me. Yeah, look what the kids do in the back of the seat, you know, when you're traveling, you know, he touched me, he touched me. All right, get apart, grow up. That's what these tough women, these power women in media are doing. And we saw Megyn Kelly do the same thing, saying, you know, well, you know, Donald Trump, he just bullied me. And Bill O'Reilly didn't do anything to help me. And, you know, that day that we were going to have the debate and he went to CNN instead and all the audience went there and we had to shut the thing down, you know, he bullied us. And I'm disappointed because CNN didn't support me and Fox News. It's like, Megan, it's called the free market. It's called competition. It's called the marketplace of ideas. And yet what she said was they should have done this for the First Amendment. Talked about how she'd like to see Donald Trump banned, but she couldn't get that done. You know, even the people at Fox News won't join her on that. See, that's the neo-fem ideal. These people who say they're power women, people who say that they're conservatives, and yet they want to censor speech and people that they don't like, just as we see the liberal Democrats want to do. And so their reaction to this, I thought, was truly amazing, along with Ted Cruz, who had also said that Kasich and said that they would have fired him. Cruz said he would have fired him, but Donald Trump said, no, he didn't do anything wrong. I'm not going to fire him. That's a good thing. And yet, when we come back, we're going to tell you what the neo-fems said about this. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host today. We have a lot of guests on the show. We've got Arthur Thompson, head of the John Birch Society. He's going to be joining us for an hour, coming up in the second hour. We also have a gaming expert who's going to be talking to us about the ways that people rig games and sporting events, because you know what we're looking at here is really a sporting event when we look at the elections. We also have increasingly a role in the vote tallies of electronic voting machines. I've talked about this at length, about the Smartmatic voting machines that the GOP used to allow people to vote online in the Utah GOP primary. They paid $80,000 for that. You may not have realized that that company has deep ties to George Soros and Hugo Chavez. I did a report on it. The ghost of Hugo Chavez haunts the GOP Utah caucus. It was a company, Smartmatic was a company that was created in Venezuela by some people who were friends of Hugo Chavez. He paid them a tremendous amount of money, and they paid him back, letting him win elections there. And, of course, that company has been involved in many, many election scandals throughout Central and South America predominantly. But they've got a foothold in America. And as we're looking at the UN Secretary General saying, when it comes to these climate change treaties, I know Obama is going to be able to do the right thing, even though he's going to be blocked and he can't legally do this. There's a legal process. He's not going to be able to get around that. But I know he's going to use executive orders to get this through. I've got confidence in him. See, they're not going to let the law stand in their way. And they're not really going to be concerned about the honest elections either. So we're going to be talking to Brian Toomey about that. We also have students at the Portland University who had a Students for Trump organization, and that turned into a mass riot as all these social justice warriors crashed that, and they're going to try again in a couple of days, and our reporters are going to be there to cover that. Our reporters are going to be in Colorado tomorrow to cover a protest at the Colorado GOP about the fact that they disenfranchised Republican voters and just selected the delegates instead of electing the delegates. We're going to be covering that as well. And our reporters are going to be in New York today. We're going to talk to them briefly in the third hour, and they're going to be on for an extended amount of time in the fourth hour. Now, going back to what we just saw happen in terms of the, I guess you could call it inside politics, but it really tells us a great deal. And this is why politics is important, because it tells us about our government. It tells us about the people who are running this. You know, you talk about crony capitalism. What we're seeing now is crony elections. We're seeing crony socialism. All these people, especially the Bernie supporters, who think that government should be the ones to dole out everything in our society, hand us everything that we want, make all the decisions, allocate the resources. Well, you might want to rethink that. If you think that's a solution to crony capitalism, understand that the people, there's that article about the guy who spent 10 years throughout Central and South America rigging elections. That was another article that we talked about in that report as well. He's now in jail, but he's trying to offer his services to people, tell them how he did it, you know, kind of bargain his way out of there so that he can get out of jail. When we look at what's happening again with this Corey Lewandowski situation. We had Kasich and Cruz say, no, fire this guy immediately. And we have Megyn Kelly actually blaming Donald Trump for Michelle Fields filing hoax assault charges. Think about that. She didn't say, well, this is a travesty of justice. He really did assault her. No, she doesn't say that. Megyn Kelly says, well, Donald Trump made her file those charges. I mean, it just never ends with these people, with the neo-fems. People like Megyn Kelly. It's just unbelievable. Tonight, that was last night, Megyn Kelly blamed the Trump campaign for Michelle Fields filing a fraudulent police report against Trump campaign manager Corey Lewandowski. She went ahead and said, Michelle Fields didn't want to press charges, but the Trump campaign demanded that she file a police report. It just never ends with these people, these victims. And even worse than the victims, well, oh, and here's another one here, okay, another feminist. So remember, we had this come out yesterday. One of the women who is selected as a delegate had been tweeting out Never Trump. And so a lot of people complained about that. GOP delegate who vowed to vote for Hillary over Trump. The Donald is a racist misogynist. Okay. So instead of, and this is a story by Paul Joseph Watson, when she was criticized for her bias, instead of trying to say, well, I have reasons that I don't like Donald Trump or this or that, instead she doubles down and she takes off the real mask, okay, calling him a racist, misogynist, flip-flopper. In other words, she is just like the social justice warriors of the left, the people who stand out there screaming, and I've seen them over and over again. I watched them for hours in New York, standing out there, repeating a three-word phrase, Trump is a racist, Trump is a racist, Trump is racist. Okay, just repeating that over and over again. Why? Because he triggered them. He stood up to their political correctness. And he did things like saying, hey, we've got borders. We understand why they want the borders opened up. That's part of destroying America, destroying Europe, destroying the sovereign nations, bringing in people in such large numbers that they cannot be assimilated. And we're not going to allow that. And there was a great statement when they had the Florida primaries. They had a Hispanic mayor in Florida who was a Trump supporter. He said, my wife, who's also Hispanic, she said, I don't know. He wants to deport people. And he goes, you came here illegally. But he goes, what would you do if somebody came into your house and wouldn't leave? You would call the police, wouldn't you? That's simply what he's doing. And he said, yeah. So then she voted for Donald Trump, because that's essentially what we're talking about. It isn't about race. It isn't targeted at any one particular group. Understand, they're targeting us when they are opening up the borders. They want to replace our population. And they want it to get violent as well. You know, they're the ones who are inciting violence by bringing in massive numbers of people, by saying you're not going to be allowed to vet the people coming in to see if they are drug cartel members, to see if they're terrorists, to see if they've got diseases even. You're not going to be allowed to do that. There's a lot of people, I think they're going to find a lot of people who are Hispanic, who have come into this country, whether they're here legally or illegally. As a matter of fact, I heard a lady call in on a local talk radio show, and she said, I'm an illegal alien here. I don't have my documents, is what she said. I don't have my documents. I'm still waiting to get them, but I'm voting for Donald Trump because I don't want America to turn into what I left. You see? You see that all the time when people move into an area, like move out to the Colorado, the Rocky Mountains, and they love the John Denver image that's been sold to them. They build their house, and they say, okay, that's it. No more people. No more people coming in and building any houses. They don't want to see it change. They want to be there, but they don't want to see it changed. So I think you're going to see a lot of Hispanics who really understand what's going on with this. But again, when we look at this, and we look at what Ted Cruz is doing, it really concerns me for him to say that we have no right to lobby and to put pressure on these delegates who are turning people away at the GOP convention in Denver, in Colorado. I guess it was in Denver. Turning people away at the door, saying if they were Trump supporters, taking their name off the ballot, saying you can't come in because you're a Trump supporter. We had the guy who reported that, who burned his card. And then they have the nerve, he has the nerve to say that Trump is acting like a mafia. Don, this is true racketeering, what the GOP is doing here. And I thought it was funny, too, because he even pronounced it as Corleone, you know. We saw that with Jeb Bush as well. If you're going to get the cultural reference to The Godfather, okay, why don't you pronounce it the way that they do it in the movies? It's Corleone. But they do this thing like the, remember the Nevada senator, Pat Geary, that was in the movie? He comes out and goes, I'd like to introduce you to Mr. Vito Corleone. Well, Corleone, that's the way Cruz says it. That's the way Jeb Bush says it. And when I was laughing about it, Rob Jacobson said, well, I think they've got the same coach. Because, you know, we've got all these close ties with the Bushes as well as the Cruz people. I want to play what Paul Manafort, and this is the guy who has been hired to do the delegate math. He points out a very uncomfortable truth for Ted Cruz in terms of the political game that's coming up here. Let's play that clip of Paul Manafort saying that April will be a very bad month for Ted Cruz.
But you do have New York coming up. I would assume you expect most of the delegates in New York.
Not only New York, but the whole Northeast. I mean, we're out of Cruz land. Cruz is not even going to be finished. He's second for the next couple of weeks. He's going to be distant thirds in a lot of places.
So, in other words, you think Trump wins New York, Connecticut, Rhode Island, Pennsylvania, Delaware, Maryland?
I think we're doing very well in all those places. All the polls show us leading, and we're just starting to put our campaigns together.
It seems like the Cruz campaign is spending a lot of time, energy, focus in districts in California, especially Los Angeles, outside the Los Angeles County. Kasich seems to be targeting the more northern part of the state, San Francisco, et cetera. Is it going to come down to June 7th?
Well, June 2nd, 7th is going to put us over, but we're not going to have to win overwhelmingly on June 7th. We're going to have...
You really...
I think we're going to
walk me through your math then.
We're going to have a ground game in California where we're going to be focusing on the congressional districts as well. We announced our state chairman today. We've been putting people on the ground. California is going to be a battleground.
So you think you can get to 1237 even before June 7th?
No, I think we'll need June 7th. But I think before June 7th, it's going to be apparent that Donald Trump
is that what you're about to say?
There's a lot of similarity to the 1980 race with Reagan and Trump. And a lot of the criticisms of Reagan in 1980 are the same ones being...
Okay, last quick. Walk me through your math.
Well, I'm not going to walk you through the math.
You don't want to walk me through the math?
I'm not going to do that yet.
But I'm going to... The people want to hear it.
Well, just keep watching, because it's going to become very apparent. April is going to be a very bad month for Ted Cruz. I mean, he'll probably finish third in delegates in April compared to...
By the end of April, what do you think he'll be at?
We'll be on our way.
Okay, that's interesting. I thought one of the funny things, I hadn't seen that clip when he started calling him Donald Reagan. He said there's a lot of parallels. Yeah, there are a lot of parallels. If you remember, this time in 1980, Ronald Reagan, everybody in the GOP establishment was saying, had absolutely no chance to win. And they had a better case that Ronald Reagan didn't have a chance to win in 1980 than they do that Donald Trump doesn't have a chance to win. At that point, they were saying, hey, you're polling 15% behind the Democrat who was an incumbent president. Remember that? And so when the people are saying, the pollsters are saying, well, Donald Trump is 15% behind Hillary Clinton in these polls, she's not president. She may be running for the third term of Obama, but she is not president. And we need to remember what happened with Ronald Reagan. As a matter of fact, with Ronald Reagan, they also said he's not a real Republican. I remember hearing that over and over again. Now, you define yourself as a Republican by how closely you are aligned with Ronald Reagan. But in 1980, the establishment, the Rockefeller establishment, was telling us that Ronald Reagan was not a real Republican because he had been a Democrat, he had been a labor union president, and he had converted as a Republican. He'd already served a term as a Republican governor, but they were saying, no, he's not a real Republican and he can't possibly win. And yet the way he won was by getting blue-collar Democrats to vote for him, the same people we see lining up behind Donald Trump. Or should we start calling him Donald Reagan? I don't know. Now, again, tomorrow we're going to have the coverage of the protest in Colorado, the protest of the elections being taken. And a lot of people who are talking about this, and we've mentioned this before, say, this is just politics. No, if you elect somebody, this is a single issue election that they're having here. It's not like you're electing a representative. I know we don't have a direct democracy, and I'm not saying that we should have a direct democracy, but we have a democratic republic where we elect representatives. And this kind of harkens back to that, except it's not the same thing. When you elect somebody to go to Congress, there's a whole slate of issues that they're going to be confronting over their term of 2 years. You're not electing them on a single issue. When you vote for somebody as a delegate to go to these elections, you are electing them for a single issue. You're saying, I want you to be a Trump person, or I want you to be a Cruz person. And when they go, not as somebody who's going to be representing Trump, who has to be convinced in the second round to go with somebody else, for example, but they already are a double agent for Ted Cruz, that's like voting for Mr. Smith to go to Washington and you get Mr. Jones to go to Washington. That's like voting for a Republican and they send a Democrat. And again, understand this is a single issue that we're talking about. It's not a whole bunch of issues. And yet, what have we seen over and over again on every single issue, whether it's the border, whether it's Obamacare, whatever, climate change, we elect these Republicans on these issues, these key issues that they run on, and they go and do something else as soon as they get there. They vote for the climate change treaty, or they fully fund the government, take away all their leverage and say, well, there's nothing I can do about it. I can't really do anything about Obamacare unless we can get a president involved as well who will make Supreme Court appointments. No, it's not that passive. There's plenty of things that they can do. But on every single issue, they have ignored you. So now, when you've got a single issue, now they're ignoring you. Now they're saying, we don't even need you in the polls. There was an interesting story to change the topic off of politics for a moment here and get back to the police state. It was an interesting story about coming out of the BBC. An airport sniffer dog finds cheese and sausages, but no Class A drugs. So they say that they've been using drugs, dogs there now, to try to test people for drugs. And he has found small bits of cheese and sausages. And when I saw this, I don't know if any of you know Wallace and Gromit. Let's play that clip here just for cultural context here.
That's it. Cheese. We'll go somewhere where there's cheese.
As Wallace and Gromit. Always looking for cheese. He's got his pet dog there, and I guess that's what they've got at the airport now. And of course, our drug war is a total failure in so many ways. Just another one here. I wish it was all as benign as that, but no, a lot of people have died. We've got a massive amount of our population locked up in jail. We've destroyed our legal system, and it's all for a UN agenda. Now, before we go on to any more news, I just want to remind you that we've got a special on Brain Force, an unprecedented special. We've had it discounted for a while, but now we've got an additional 25% off. The total is 45% off retail. That's Brain Force and InfoWarsLife.com, an unprecedented 45% off the retail price. I use it extensively. It's one of Rob Dew's favorite supplements as well. You can really feel this focus you, but it doesn't make you jittery. It doesn't keep you up at night like other things, caffeine, coffee, and other things like that. It uses natural brain activation ingredients like yerba mate extract, alpha GPC. Some of these ingredients are prescription in Europe, but you can get them here at InfoWarsLife.com. 45% off retail. That's Brain Force. Get it while it's on sale. Take a look at the reviews. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to be joined in the next hour by Arthur Thompson, head of the John Birch Society. We're going to talk about Ted Cruz's involvement with the New World Order, with his Heidi Cruz being the first lady of the North American Union. We're going to talk about the background of Ted Cruz. I've been concerned about Ted Cruz for a very long time. As I pointed out, I think it was yesterday or the day before, talked about how we had the massive rally at the Alamo for the open carry, the Second Amendment. We had people who were being harassed down there for legally carrying long arms openly. This is before they relaxed some of the open carry laws. Now you can carry pistols openly if you have a concealed carry permit. But at the time, you could carry long rifles. You could shoulder them over your, put them over your shoulder. And they were doing that as a protest so that people get used to seeing someone who doesn't have a uniform carrying a firearm, because that's okay. It really is okay, folks. Think about it. You know, you don't want the government to have a monopoly on force. That's really the purpose of the Second Amendment. So we had this massive rally. Every politician, every conservative gun activist was there, except Ted Cruz, even though he was in the motel room across the street, having a, literally having a tea party with some lady donors over there, with a grabbing some money, talking to them about Obamacare. The guy who is all the time talking about the Constitution and the Second Amendment could not be bothered to even wave out the window at the protest that was going on there in support of the Second Amendment. I've seen so many different ways that Ted Cruz has been phony, but I think the mask is going to come off. We're going to talk in detail about many different aspects of Ted Cruz, the, I believe, double agent, when we are joined by Arthur Thompson. We're also going to be joined by Portland Students for Trump, who were shut down by a massive riot. We're going to talk to them in the third hour, as well as our reporters who are in New York, and they're going to be in Colorado for the demonstration tomorrow. Of course, there were 27,000 people in New York who came out to see Bernie Sanders. We've got a story up on InfoWars.com. 2016, the year Americans found out their elections are rigged. Yeah, we're finding out. And we're finding out that it's the Democrats and the Republicans who are rigging these elections. I want to give you some more background to it. There's an excellent report here. This is a local anchor who is exposing the Partnership for New American Economy, Sanctuary Cities, and the grants to make sanctuary cities. Let's run this clip.
You can imagine my surprise when I found out that Fargo, along with 19 other cities, half of them, by the way, being sanctuary cities, if you know that term, was chosen by the Partnership for a New American Economy, whatever that's supposed to mean. I'll talk more about that organization here in just a moment. But as a winner of this grant program called the Gateway for Growth Award, Fargo won this based on our quote-unquote welcoming attitude towards immigrants and new Americans. Now, the grant is primarily used for educating, wait till you hear this, primarily used for educating you and I, the public, on the merits of expanded immigration, which will lead me back to who is the Partnership for a New American Economy. This is a group which is headed by Michael Bloomberg, Rupert Murdoch, Steve Ballmer, Bob Iger from Disney. Remember the old Disney company just recently that was asking the American employees that employed to train cheaper foreign labor so the American could essentially train themselves out of a job? Yeah, that Disney. These are the bigwigs that want basically open borders for cheap labor to make their shareholders happy with bigger returns. Also a member of the Partnership for the New American Economy is Grand Forks Mayor Michael Brown. Now, I spoke with Mayor Brown's community and government relations person earlier today. His name is Peter Haga. He said he was not exactly sure why Brown is a member of this organization, and he assumed it had to do with dealing with immigration and workforce issues, saying that, hey, Grand Forks is doing any and everything.
Okay, we're going to go to break. We're going to be right back with more of that on the other side. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're going to be joined by Arthur Thompson of the John Birch Society in the next segment. Let me read you a clip. We're going to go back to that video that we're just listening to before we had to go to break. This is an article that's up on the New American, the John Birch Society's website. Soros fears a collapse of the EU due to a refugee crisis. In other words, he doesn't have any concerns, as I point out here. Doesn't have any concerns about the people of Europe, about the consequences of the open borders. Oh, he's really concerned about his European Union. This is what they say in the article. What does billionaire leftist George Soros fear? Well, not the hundreds of thousands of Middle Eastern refugees pouring into Europe, or the possibility that included within could be hundreds or maybe thousands of terrorists. He expresses no worry about the cultural problems or the security concerns Middle Eastern immigrants have already brought into the European continent. No, Soros fears the real threat of collapse of the Schengen system, in which the 26 European Union member nations have abolished any real border control at their internal borders. So that's what he's concerned about. He's concerned that it's going to affect their consolidation, because the consolidation is always economic first, and then it becomes political. And he's worried that people are starting to wake up. It's just starting to happen perhaps even faster than they expected when they wanted to open up these borders to collapse the countries. Now, we got a local anchor that we were just playing out of CBS in North Dakota. And he was putting this together. And he says, wait a minute. Look at this. People who are promoting sanctuary cities. These are people like Rupert Murdoch, you know, Fox News, the guy who puts in a neo-feminist as the key anchor, Megyn Kelly. You're selling us that agenda. Rupert Murdoch, who's given the maximum amount he can under law to Hillary Clinton, who knows how much he's given to her super PACs. Then also the Disney Corporation. Let's pick up with his breakdown of what's going on there. He's starting to realize and put this together, comes out with it on the local news there in South Dakota.
Also a member of the Partnership for the New American Economy is Grand Forks Mayor Michael Brown. Now, I spoke with Mayor Brown's community and government relations person earlier today. His name is Peter Haga. He said he was not exactly sure why Brown is a member of this organization, and he assumed it had to do with dealing with immigration and workforce issues, saying that, hey, Grand Forks is doing any and everything it can to bring in new workers to help fill the lack of workforce. Again, many people would say that's just basically cheap labor. Now, the Partnership for a New American Economy also partners with an organization called Welcoming America, which, oh, by the way, is partially funded by none other than, we can bring him up here, this guy, hopefully we're going to show you in a moment, George Soros.
There he is.
If you're not familiar with Mr. Soros, please Google him. He is a big, big proponent of open borders. Now, many people who are critics of Welcoming America and this new Partnership for a New American Economy are coming out and warning people about an all-out propaganda campaign really focused on the 20 cities that won this Gateways for Growth Award and/or grant, which, as I just mentioned, Fargo is one of those 20 cities. Now, some are saying this campaign will include elected leaders, such as possibly Mayor Brown from Grand Forks. Now,
Yeah, there you go. In case you don't know who George Soros is, well, if you're a listener to this show, you know who George Soros is. You may not be aware of his connections, as I pointed out before, to Smartmatic, the electronic voting machine, the largest electronic voting machine company in the world. Of course, the guy who is running that was a vice chair of George Soros' Open Society Foundation. And this is a company whose electronic voting machines have been the center of many, many complaints of rigged elections throughout Central and Latin America. They're coming to the United States. They were involved in the Utah GOP primary that they had, letting people vote online there. There are a lot of concerns about electronic voting. We're going to be talking later in the show to Brian Toomey, a man who is an expert in gaming and the way that online sports gaming can be rigged. We're going to be talking to him. And coming up next, we're going to be talking to Arthur Thompson of the John Birch Society. He's going to talk to us about Heidi Cruz, the First Lady of the North American Union. North American Union. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. We're going to be interviewing Art Thompson. He is the head of the John Birch Society. Of course, you can find them at jbs.org, thenewamerican.com. Before we go live to Mr. Thompson, I want to play a clip for you, something, a presentation that he does. Heidi Cruz, First Lady of the North American Union. We're going to break that down, talking to him live. But, you know, when we have an election, one of the things that we want to do is we want to first obviously ask, what are these people proposing to do? And then we want to say, well, can we trust them in this? Are they authentic? You know, we look at somebody like Bernie Sanders. You know, I think Bernie is really authentic, but I don't like what he's proposing to do. I don't like socialism, but he's authentic. But then on the other hand, we got somebody like Ted Cruz, and he says some good things about supporting the Constitution. He wants to appoint judges who are originalists, who take the Constitution not as a living document, but who take it as written, who take it as with its original intent, people like Justice Scalia was. He says many things like that. He says he supports the Second Amendment, so forth and so on. But then we see that he's changed his position in some very uncomfortable ways when it comes to things like these trade partnerships and then voting first to shut down the constitutional process to ratify these trade treaties, the transatlantic, the trans-Pacific partnership, to shut down the constitutional process, which says 67% of the senators will approve this. No, no, they changed it to a simple majority. They shut down any amendments. They shut down any debating. They shut down any filibustering of this. They said, once we give this secretly negotiated agreement to you, then it's going to be run through in a certain period of time. If you don't bring it to the floor, it's going to go there automatically. You're not going to be able to talk about it or amend it. It's just going to be there. Okay. Now, he voted for that process. It didn't quite make it the first time. He got a second chance at it, and then he's getting closer to the presidential election, so then he votes against it. Okay. So who are these people? I want to play this clip from Arthur Thompson about Heidi Cruz, and then we'll talk to him directly. Let's run that clip.
And yet, these were the recommendations out of this committee of the Council on Foreign Relations, which lists Heidi Cruz as one of those task force members. And it says here, it's got an asterisk back by her name, and the asterisk says this: the individual has endorsed the report and submitted an additional or dissenting view. So you go back to the dissenting view of Heidi Cruz, and this is what she says. I support the task force report and its recommendations aimed at building a safer and more prosperous North America. And then she goes on and says that she is just concerned that we maintain the ability of these banks to be able to run the banking regulations and that sort of thing, instead of making it a state thing. Well, that's no surprise, because at the same time, Heidi Cruz had Morgan connections, and then subsequently went on and became part of the Goldman Sachs banking empire. And incidentally, her husband got a very sweetheart deal from Goldman Sachs for his campaign that he just forgot to mention to anybody in his public disclosure.
Yeah, and that's a very interesting way that he got around that. Essentially, he declared it, but he didn't put it in the place where anybody would look for. See, that's the cleverness of Ted Cruz. And joining us right now is Arthur Thompson. Art has held virtually every volunteer and staff position in the John Birch Society, including National Director of Development and Communications and National Director of Field Activities. For several years, he represented the John Birch Society in a variety of media events, including appearing on 60 Minutes and was for a short time on the Speakers Bureau of the John Birch Society. Thank you so much for joining us, Mr. Thompson. When I look at that particular declaration of Ted Cruz, to me, that is the kind of lawyerly tricks that I seem to come to expect from Ted Cruz. The fact that he would file it in the wrong place and put it there and wait until somebody had discovered it and then say, oh, no, we actually did file it. We just didn't tell the Federal Elections Commission about this loan because it was very important for him at the time to distance himself from Goldman Sachs. People had pointed out some of these connections that his wife had with Goldman Sachs, the Council on Foreign Relations, and he called them a pit of vipers. But then he was taking a large donation from that pit of vipers when he was running for Senate.
Well, that's true. Before we get into it too much, though, I'd like to point out that we tell people about all the candidates.
Yes.
We don't take positions as to who to vote for and that sort of thing. We stay out of partisan politics, but we will have things like articles on Trump that are also revealing, just asking questions, bringing out facts. We want people to understand what's going on before they go into the voting booth.
Absolutely.
And so we get hit from all sides when we bring these things out, whether it's Trump people or Cruz people or whomever it may be.
And that's a key thing, too. I think people need to understand, you know, when I looked at Donald Trump, at the very beginning, I was very much opposed to Donald Trump because what I saw happening was a cult of personality like I had seen with Barack Obama. He, at that point, had not really talked about any issues, and I really wasn't aware personally of how hard he had hit the trade issues going back into the 1990s, the mid-1980s, how he was running ads in the New York Times complaining about how we were being ripped off in trade and so forth, and talking about an America First foreign policy. So I didn't see that, and I hadn't seen him talk about any policies. I just saw a cult of personality, and I thought, boy, this is really dangerous. But, you know, we have a cult of personality that develops around every single candidate. You know, there's a cult of personality around Donald Trump. There's one around Ted Cruz. And we need to recognize that. We need to not become a part of that. And we need to pull back and say, where do they stand on the issues? And now that we're into the campaign this long, we can understand where they are on the issues. But then there's also the issue of who these people are. Are they authentic? Who's been their influence? And, you know, what is going on behind the scenes? And I think that's where it is very important to take a look at the connections of Heidi Cruz to Goldman Sachs, particularly to Wall Street in general. Because when she was on that commission with Robert Zoellick, she was working for a different bank. And so when she says, well, I did a dissenting opinion on the findings of the Council on Foreign Relations about a North American Union, she wasn't dissenting too much because the guy who was running it, Robert Zoellick, hired her to come join him at Goldman Sachs after that.
Well, working with Robert Pastor, she helped write this plan for a North American Union.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
She was a five-year member of the Council on Foreign Relations. And let's put that into a little bit of perspective, if we can. First of all, the Council on Foreign Relations stands for a one-world government under a managed economy, a socialism in a word.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you have to be vetted before you become a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. I believe you have to have at least two other members sponsor you. And then you go before a membership committee, and they take a look at whether or not they're going to allow you to be a member. And so you have to go through that process. Apparently, they liked what they saw and okayed her membership. So when we get closer to the campaign, however, she drops that membership. You have to ask the question why. And the other thing is, too, that during all this process, Cruz was for these treaties, the
yes.
TPP and the TTIP, et cetera.
And he wrote an op-ed piece with Paul Ryan in support of these treaties as well.
That's right. Now, the thing is that he says, for instance, on one of the Republican debates, he said, I never have supported the TPP. Well, technically that may be true, but he supported the process of negotiating the TPP. And we have letters from his constituents showing that support. So he may claim now that it has been a done deal, it's been negotiated through, that he disagrees with it. But he didn't disagree with it 2 years ago or 3 years ago.
That's right. He was writing op-ed pieces of Paul Ryan saying, in theory, you know, calling it free trade. And look, I would agree with free trade if we had free trade, if we had a free market. But when you have thousands of pages of an agreement that are written by foreign by multinational corporate lawyers and lobbyists, and our elected representatives are not allowed to see it until very late in the process. And then when you had Senator Sessions take a look at it, he said, this is a living agreement. It isn't, even if you understand what these 5,000 pages of managed trade are going to be, at that point, you're going to be creating a multinational commission that is going to have the authority to change the terms of this agreement. In other words, a multinational commission that you have no control over, that you don't appoint anybody, you can't remove anyone from, they're going to be able to manage your economy by adjusting these trade issues. And that's what Senator Sessions was talking about. He said, this is destruction of sovereignty. This is not free trade. It also has big issues in terms of immigration as well that he was talking about. And that's one of the reasons why I believe Senator Sessions endorsed Donald Trump. He'd been working with him from August through that point. And he has never endorsed anybody in his entire career. I think it's very interesting that the one person who looked at that very in a very detailed way said, this is going to destroy our sovereignty. It's going to create issues with immigration besides what it does to our trade and our jobs.
That's right. And we'll only be one vote amongst many votes regarding our own economy. Mm-hmm. We're allowing these people to come in and just basically dictate to us.
Yes.
And then there's environmental regulations. There's all sorts of things that come into play. In fact, if you look at the TPP, you'll discover that only five or six chapters have anything to do with trade. All the rest of it has to do with regulations on environment and things of that nature. Agenda 21, if you will, for those who understand that process.
And of course, we've also got the Electronic Freedom Foundation. The EFF is talking about how this is not trade. This is about controlling the internet. It controls all these different issues. It truly is a sovereignty issue. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Art Thompson of the John Birch Society. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host today. We're talking to Art Thompson, head of the John Birch Society. You can find them at thenewamerican.com. You can find their articles as well as the organization itself. Find out information about that at jbs.org. We're going to go back to Mr. Thompson in just a moment. Before we do, I want to let you know about a new sale that we have, an unprecedented discount off of BrainForce. 25% off the price that we have there, which is already a discount. That is 45% off the retail for BrainForce right now. Again, that is something that is a favorite of the InfoWars crew, Rob Dew, who we're going to be talking to in the next segment. Quick update about what's going on in New York City, where Rob is. Rob is jetting across this country like he was Donald Trump with a private jet, except we don't have a private jet. So this helps to support our operation, helps to get us to New York, get us to the protests in Colorado coming up tomorrow, as well as the situation that's coming up in Portland University with the students we're going to be talking to later in the show. Again, Rob Dew is able to do all this stuff because of things like BrainForce that helps him to focus his mind. It keeps you from getting jittery. It doesn't create a jittery situation like caffeine or some other supplements do. And BrainForce uses natural brain activation ingredients like yerba mate extract, alpha GPC. Some of these ingredients are prescription only in Europe, but you can get them at InfoWarsLife.com at 45% off retail right now with our special unprecedented discount off of BrainForce at InfoWarsLife.com. Check out the reviews. We have hundreds of five-star reviews at the site. See what other people say it does for them. Let's go back to Mr. Thompson. Now, Mr. Thompson, we were talking about Ted Cruz and Heidi Cruz and the troubling connections to not only Goldman Sachs, but to the Council on Foreign Relations. We have an article on InfoWars.com today talking about his connections to Wall Street. Ted Cruz is now begging Wall Street for cash. They say in stark contrast to his campaign trail rhetoric, where he promises voters he'll go after big banks, go after crony capitalism. He is now courting the very banks for yet more campaign cash, and we're told that he's received $12 million from Wall Street donors already. And, of course, we've got the situation with his campaign finance advisors. One of them that he's brought in as a trusted advisor is Neil Bush, of all people. I mean, would you want to get financial advice from a guy who was at the epicenter of the savings and loan scandal, which is the biggest scandal we had in the financial community before we had the collapse in 2008? I mean, how's that for an advisor?
You can't make this stuff up. You know, I like to. You know, the difference between fiction and reality is that fiction has to be credible.
Yeah.
And so, you know, to make it believable.
That's true.
But anyway, it's interesting to watch these things.
Yeah,
we live in very interesting times. I think this is probably the most interesting of the elections in my lifetime.
Yeah, absolutely. We're talking about that commission that Heidi Cruz is on with the Council on Foreign Relations. Talk about the recommendations that they had there, because I just found their recommendations to be breathtaking. They wanted to have, from my understanding, a North American union with the U.S., Canada, and Mexico, and a common border around the three countries patrolled by Homeland Security, among other things. Did we lose Mr. Thompson? Did we drop off there? That's the key, folks, and I think we lost contact with, is he back with us? No, I think we're frozen there. That's the key, folks. When we're talking about the North American Union, understand, I guess, you know, when we talk about the eligibility issues and whether Ted Cruz is Canadian or not, you know, I guess he could be the North American Union president because he's got kind of a Latin American connection. He's a Canadian. Why not be president of the United States? I was just saying before we lost connection, Mr. Thompson, when we look at the recommendations of the Council on Foreign Relations report that Heidi Cruz was part of, they were saying, let's have a common border around the three countries and we'll patrol that border with Homeland Security.
Well, that's right. And the other things they want to do, too, is to merge healthcare, police, the armed forces, that kind of thing. A lot of people don't realize that one of the reasons why the people in power want socialized medicine is so that that can be merged with the other socialized medicine of these countries they want us to merge with.
Yeah.
The reason they want a national police force is to make it more easy to merge that with the Mexican federales and the hybrid system they have in Canada and so on and so forth. So all of these things, banking regulations, environmental regulations, and what have you, are all being changed so that they can be merged in this process. It's just a lot easier.
We're going to talk about that in a lot more detail because what they do before they set up a merged sovereignty is they merge everything economically. That's what these trade deals are about. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Art Thompson of the John Birch Society. We're talking to Art Thompson, the head of the John Birch Society, talking about issues of global importance because we're talking about global governance and how it is being rapidly brought in, the foundations that are being laid. Who is a part of this? As we vet these candidates, we need to understand who these guys are, not just what they say they're going to do. But before we go back to Mr. Thompson, I wanted to check in with our reporters. Rob Dew and Joe Biggs are in New York City. These guys are jetting around like they're Donald Trump, and they're going to be in Colorado tomorrow. But tell us some of your agenda. You're going to be on the fourth hour with Anthony Gucciardi to talk in depth about what's happening there in New York. Tell us what you're up to.
Well, thank you, David. Rob Dew reporting for Infowars.com in the heart of New York City, corner of Lexington and 42nd Street. And right behind me is the hotel where the GOP is going to have their gala tonight. And this is the New York State GOP, and this is the Grand Hyatt Hotel. But here is the big story. The NYPD believes in walls. Take a look around you. As you see, walls are everywhere. They built these all around this area at a six-block radius to keep the protesters from, I guess, entering the hotel.
Are you undocumented GOPers? Or?
I think we're documented libertarians.
There you go.
Definitely not undocumented. But look, and then Kit Daniels tweeted out today, Trump campaign blasts Zuckerberg, open borders CEO, lives behind private security wall. Okay, so obviously people think walls work, right, Joe Biggs?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, and also we were told if we complain about this, it's going to get higher. So we've got to watch. We've got to make sure we keep our complaining down so it doesn't get higher.
But the wall news isn't done. Down in Tulane University in New Orleans, one of the Greeks they have for their social event, they built a wall around their private property. Well, somebody painted Make America Great Again on it. And, of course, that triggered everybody. Apparently, they're alleging some Tulane football players went and tore down that wall. So nobody can have free speech. You know, we're going to build walls. But people are building walls everywhere. And it's just amazing what's going on. It's like some groups are allowed to have free speech, like the group that'll be here tonight. They're going to be allowed to scream and yell at everybody. And but the NYPD's building walls to, I guess, keep people safe.
Well, last night's protest, the Trump protest in Pittsburgh, got out of control as well. I believe there were three people who were injured, four officers in that. And we're expecting way more people here. You know, there's been over 1,500 people who said they're going to come to this event today. But that's just people on Facebook. You've got to factor in the fact that there's a lot of people out here in downtown and Manhattan. They're going to come out. They're going to see this, walk by, and then become a part of it. Crowd's going to get large. It's going to be crazy. So stay tuned for more reports from this gala tonight outside of the Donald Trump event.
And David, okay. I just want to add one thing. Mm-hmm. It is, like you said before in the last segment, it is because of the support of the people who are buying the products, who are PrisonPlanet.tv members, that we can do all this.
Yes.
We're here in New York. Tomorrow morning, 6 a.m., we're flying to Denver. And then we're going to be there for the GOP protest at the Capitol. They moved it to the Capitol. And then we're flying to Portland. So thank you to everybody out there that is supporting us. We got a great special on BrainForce. I took my BrainForce this morning. I feel great. It is an amazing product. I can't say enough about it. Oh, yeah. Definitely clears you up. And, you know, you've taken some too, David.
Oh, yeah.
Gone and done some of these live debates.
Oh, absolutely. And, yeah, I would call it, I'd call it Brain Focus. And we do thank you for your support. And as Rob is pointing out, we've got a special, an additional 25% off. So it's a total of 45% off of BrainForce right now at InfoWarsLife.com. Yeah, I think it's interesting when you look at Zuckerberg, you know, he's got the Facebook wall, but just like these people at the university, you're not allowed to put just anything you want up there. You know, they take that down as well. So, you know, there's multiple layers of hypocrisy that we've got going on here. And you're going to be joining Anthony Gucciardi in the fourth hour to talk about what's happening there. And again, you're in New York. You're across the street from a GOP meeting that's going to be happening there. The elite establishment is going to be there tonight, and there's going to be some people, we think, showing up to protest that, and the police think that as well, because they're already barricading you guys out of that area, because you're dangerous, you know?
That's right. More walls, I guess. I think what they're doing is the right thing, because this probably will get out of hand. Already there's people in Chicago taunting the people in New York, saying, hey, we shut it down. Can you do?
Can you guys whoop us in what we did, is what they said.
Right. So obviously there's taunting going on between the cities. You know, now they're telling the report came out that the police department in Chicago has to proclaim that they're racist. And there's these statistics that they're throwing out as a task force set up by Rahm Emanuel. So we'll see what happens tonight. We will be here. Multiple angles, and and we'll be checking in back with Anthony Gucciardi in just a couple minutes or a couple hours.
That's right, in the fourth hour. Thank you very much. That's Rob Dew and Joe Biggs, our reporters in New York. And of course, we don't want to have any violence at any of these protests. We don't want to make heroes out of the people who are shutting down the elections. And I want to go back to Mr. Thompson of R. Thompson of the John Birch Society, and I want to talk more about what's going on behind the scenes with the North American Union, with the Trilateral Commission, with these trade treaties that are going on. But before we do, real quickly, I want to ask you, Mr. Thompson, what's your opinion about these processes now that are being exposed in the election? The fact that we have superdelegates, Hillary Clinton started out on the Democrat side already with 15% of what she needed before any elections were held. She had 15% of the votes that she needed there. As some of the papers in New York talked to her, they said, talked to some of the superdelegates. They said, would you change your vote over to Bernie Sanders if he won the popular vote in New York? No. I would never leave Hillary Clinton. And then on the Republican side, it seems to me it's even worse because we've got these double agent delegates who, you know, you vote for a guy to represent you. Trump gets the delegates or Cruz gets the delegates or whatever. They go in and take the delegates that were appointed for one guy and they're declared their loyalty beforehand for that. And then you've got GOP party members saying, we're not going to let people in here who aren't already loyal to our preferred candidate, and we're going to shut the voters out of the election process altogether. What do you make of this corruption as I see it in these two parties? Do you see it as corruption?
Well, I've had a little experience in the Republican Party behind the scenes. And let me put it to you this way. The only difference between the Democrat and Republican parties and the mafia is that the parties don't kill you.
Yeah, yeah.
Other than that, there's not directly a lot of similarity.
Yeah, not directly. They may send you to foreign wars that aren't declared, but they don't directly go out and kill you. But yeah, it is a protection racket, and they do. No, seriously, though. I mean, I've put out many times, I've tweeted out, I've put out videos saying, you know, the rhinos have gone full RICO because it does look like the mafia. It looks like racketeering. It looks like corrupt organizations, and that's both parties. They've been given a duopoly. And they walk this line back and forth saying, well, you know, we're a private organization. We can do whatever we want. Shut up and sit down. You know, it's our party. We'll do whatever we wish. We'll burn it down if we want to. But then they also have all these special government powers where they control access to the debates, where they control access to the ballot and all these other issues as well.
That's true. But behind the scenes that the delegates don't see is where the real action takes place. And they do everything they can to hide that from the average delegate. So he'll leave a convention or a caucus, a big caucus, not small ones, and not even understand what's happened. He mm-hmm. will come out fully satisfied that it was a democratic process and everything else. Now, if you're going to have a caucus system, then you should have small caucuses that don't much reach beyond a precinct. If you do...
I think we lost him there.
...the individuals in the party.
I'm sorry, we lost that a little bit. You said if we're going to have caucuses, we have it at the local level. Go ahead.
Yeah, not much higher than the precinct level.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you have these big things that you have, like you saw in I think it was Utah and that sort of thing. Wherever it was. You have thousands of people coming to a single caucus.
Yes.
That's dangerous. You need it down to the precinct level.
And that's true with everything. And, of course, the John Birch Society has been at the forefront of people trying to get people to understand government is a difficult thing to control. It always wants to consolidate power, and it always wants to tend towards corruption. There's always that temptation. So you need to kind of keep it as small and as local as possible in every different issue, whether you're talking about control of the police or whether you're talking about how the political parties are going to be done. That's always true. But then there's also the issue, Mr. Thompson, the fact that they reserve so many what they call superdelegates in the Democrat Party, but of course the Republicans do that as well. They don't necessarily call them that, but they reserve spots for about 150 some odd delegates, which is about the size of the state of Texas, which is the second largest. It's about roughly the equivalent number of the delegates out of Texas. Only California has more with about 170, but they have about 150 so delegates that are party establishment. And so I think that's a very clear signal that they are setting this thing up to rig it from the get-go, isn't it?
Well, it appears that way. They will never, ever want a constitutional conservative to have a position of power within the party or as a delegate, or I mean, as a candidate for the presidency of the United States. What we see is a repetition of what they did to Barry Goldwater in 1964. Now, they weren't able to stop Barry Goldwater. He got the nomination. But the same people, including today, the sons of the mm-hmm. same people, are involved in trying to stop this democratic process.
Yes.
George Romney was very active in trying to destroy the John Birch Society and the Goldwater campaign. He was very active in raising money for Saul Alinsky, and you can verify that, just go online and look it up. And now his son, Mitt, is doing much the same thing.
Yeah.
So it kind of runs in the family, if you will.
Oh yeah, it's a multi-generational thing. And of course, we'd look also at the National Review, taking an unprecedented movement this year, devoting an entire issue to op-ed pieces against one candidate. And what's the beef that they have with Donald Trump? It isn't the fact that he runs casinos, okay? It isn't the fact that he had multiple wives, the things that people are attacking him on a personal level. No, their beef with Donald Trump is the fact that he doesn't buy into their neocon foreign policy. He has America First foreign policy. He doesn't want to buy into these foreign treaties that they're pushing. And so the National Review and these other establishment, of course, there was a long war I'm aware of with National Review and William F. Buckley against the John Birch Society because you guys supported America First and you were true conservatives. And we lost that second voice. The Republicans joined in with the Democrats to essentially set us up as the world's policemen, to have a continual state of war, to have what they call free and open trade, but what really is a managed trade situation, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And just today, now I don't know if it's dated today or not, but I got it today on the internet. Somebody sent it to me, an attack piece by the National Review against the John Birch Society and Trump. In other words, the John Birch Society is this really rotten organization run by kooks, megalomaniacs, and that kind of thing. And oh, by the way, Trump's the same thing. So it was a pretty vicious attack. It's probably one of the worst attacks against us in a long time.
Well, it's interesting because truly he is an America First person, but that's not a bad thing, except for the National Review. They have totally lost their credibility, Mr. Thompson. You know, it was just, I think it was the middle of February. It was before the South Carolina primary where he was asking about the 28 pages. He said, hey, the 28 secret pages of the 9/11 report, when those come out, you're going to find out it wasn't Iraq, it was Saudi Arabia. And, of course, we've had Walter Jones from North Carolina on the Alex Jones Show many times talking about it, and people who were part of the 9/11 commission. We had Bob Graham, who was the Senate chair of the Select Intelligence Committee, going on 60 Minutes then this last weekend saying, hey, we want to see this come out. This is information the American public needs to know. There's no reason this should be classified. We saw Senator Kerry also say that. He was on the commission. So now this is something that has hit 60 Minutes. It's hit the mainstream media. They're saying we need to release this. But when Donald Trump said this at the debate, National Review came out, and in the very first paragraph says Donald Trump is a 9/11 truther. He sounded like a caller into the Alex Jones Show. Well, now, again, National Review has been exposed for the fraud that they are. Everybody is asking, why can't we see these 28 pages, including the people who were on the 9/11 commission, said it should have never been classified in the first place.
Well, that's right. It you know, the right of the people to know is paramount.
Yes.
They can't make the right decisions if they don't have the right information. It's just that simple. Now, I know Walter Jones. I've sat with him in his office. He could not tell me certain things that he would have loved the American people to know, because he's sworn as a committee member not to do that on that report. But, you know, there's an awful lot of things that the American people are not aware of that they're holding back from them, whether it's in the world of terrorism or anything else. I've written a booklet on terrorism, has put out a video on it. You can send for it. And basically, we make the premise that the terrorist organizations have not changed any since the 1970s. They just hide it from the American people as to what it really is, so that we can't hit the right target.
And they keep rebranding it. You know, it can be the Mujahideen, then it becomes Al-Qaeda, then it becomes ISIS, then who knows what the next instantiation of it will be, the next branding label that they come up with.
But basically, it's still run out of Moscow.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And these are Moscow-trained or Russian-trained assets, like al-Zawahiri, who is now the head of Al-Qaeda, and that sort of thing. There are a lot of defectors out of the KGB that have come forward and written books to show us that Muslim terrorism is a product made in Moscow, and they've been working at it for 20 years. They've literally sent tens of thousands of Muslim Russians and you know, the people from the old USSR into the Middle East, into all aspects of society, to create the condition to build what they now see, what you now see on television. But if we don't understand that, then we can't get rid of Muslim terrorism in and of itself.
That's correct. And, of course, we've also got our government finding ways to get arms to the terrorists as well. wouldn't you agree that Saudi Arabia has been used as a surrogate for the United States? And, of course, I think one of the reasons that they want this classified is because it would embarrass the Saudi government. And the Saudi government has been a key component of keeping the U.S. dollar as a world reserve currency with a petrodollar that was worked out with Nixon and Henry Kissinger. Once they let the gold standard, once that became exposed as a fraud, people realized they didn't have any gold to back the dollar. So then what they started doing was they worked with the Saudis to establish the petrodollar to denominate the sale of oil in dollars worldwide. And that's a very important relationship there, isn't it?
It is. And something that people need to look at is the recent developments relative to the problems in the oil industry. You know, because of the price of oil being so low and the Saudis being part of that process of keeping it low, they've been able to come into the American companies that have found themselves into a bind because of that price, and they're bailing them out.
Absolutely.
So what you're seeing is that the Saudis are taking over American oil company.
We've got to go to a break. We're going to come back and continue to talk to Art Thompson of the John Birch Society. When we come back, I want to talk about not only the North American Union, but the Trilateral Commission and how that's reflected in these trade treaties, as well as get Mr. Thompson's opinion on what a natural-born citizen is. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Art Thompson from the John Birch Society. We've been talking about the connections of Heidi Cruz to Goldman Sachs and, more troubling, to the connections to the Council on Foreign Relations. I want to ask Mr. Thompson at this point. Mr. Thompson, the John Birch Society is an ardent supporter of the Constitution. Taking it as it's written, we call that an originalist interpretation. We say, you know, what do the words say? What do these terms, like militia or natural-born citizen, what did they mean by that? That was something that was not defined in the Constitution because it was well understood what those words meant. And, of course, you can modify the Constitution if you try to change the definition of those words. That's a very subtle way to do that. We've got a lot of people who are questioning the eligibility of Ted Cruz to be president. We've got one guy who's a law professor. He's running for president just so he can get Ted Cruz disqualified. He's running for president so he'll have standing to challenge him in court because he doesn't believe he's a natural-born citizen. Ted Cruz's former law professor at Harvard, Lawrence Tribe, says, well, look, I believe in a living constitution. I think that we just ought to, you know, the Constitution just ought to be changed at will based on how we feel about certain issues. But he says Ted Cruz says he supports an originalist interpretation. He says he would appoint that kind of judge, and yet that kind of judge would say that Ted Cruz is not a natural-born citizen. Where do you fall on this issue? How do you understand the term natural-born citizen as it was originally meant by the founders of the country?
Well, first of all, let me predicate my opinion with a comment that, you know, I'm a little tired of the hypocrisy that's involved in this presidential campaign. One of the things that bothers me in this regard is that we had a man who ran for president, and there was a question as to his citizenship, mm-hmm. that he was born of a foreign father in the country of Kenya. And it created such a flap that finally they said, okay, it's an American mother, and he was born in Hawaii, and there's a lot of evidence that that Hawaiian birth certificate was forged.
Yes, layered.
Now,
photoshopped.
Yeah, exactly. And so the people who were concerned about that at the time, today have changed their mind that we have a man who was born of an American woman in a foreign country by a foreigner. You know, it doesn't matter what country he's a foreign citizen of, who is now, again, running for president, but that's okay.
Yeah. Yeah, isn't that amazing?
People who questioned it about Obama.
Isn't that amazing? It bothered me so much, especially a lot of the people who understood that natural-born citizen would be both parents already citizens and the person born in America or an American territory, like a military base or whatever, but born in America with both parents already being American citizens. Yeah, we had two running. We had Marco Rubio, but especially Ted Cruz, who wasn't even born in America, and everybody just gives him a pass. As you point out, it doesn't matter what countries are involved. It doesn't matter the skin color. And a lot of people are saying, oh, you're just doing this because you're racist. I wonder, is that really the issue? I mean, are they going to let this go because now this is a Republican and, you know, they were upset because they just wanted to use that against Barack Obama?
Well, what I fear is this. It was pretty obvious that the birther movement was started by one of Hillary's people. That was done in order to try and negate Obama's influence so she could be the nominee for president of the United States. Now, if Cruz gets the nomination, what do you think Hillary's going to do?
yeah.
You know, yeah. These are things that a lot of people haven't extended the lines on.
Yeah, exactly.
All it takes is, you know, there have been several judges who've already said that Cruz is eligible.
It's going to get really messy. Well, stay with us on the other side of the break. We're going to talk to Mr. Thompson about what he thinks the definition of a natural-born citizen is. Stick with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Art Thompson of the John Birch Society. Before we had to go to a break, we were talking about natural-born citizen. This comes up because we just had another court ruling Ted Cruz is being challenged in multiple states. He's already had a Pennsylvania court rule that he is eligible to run, regardless of what the media, saying, according to their understanding of what a natural-born citizen is. We've now had a New Jersey court do the same, but there are multiple challenges to Ted Cruz. We've been asked about it directly, and in the debate, he just deflected it. Like a master lawyer, he just says, well, I've argued before the Supreme Court. I know the Constitution. I'm eligible. He doesn't say why. He doesn't defend it. We've had his former law professor say, look, if you take an originalist view of the Constitution, the kind of judge that Ted Cruz said he would appoint, that judge would say that he is not qualified. And so does Ted Cruz support a living Constitution? Does he support removing constitutional issues that get in his way? We've already seen how that works out with President Obama. And of course, this whole thing was brought up when Obama was running. And as Mr. Thompson just pointed out, many people believe that a lot of the birther movement was connected to Hillary Clinton. So this is an issue that's not going to go away if Hillary gets the nomination, if Ted Cruz were to get the nomination. So Mr. Thompson, what is your opinion about natural born citizen? We've seen in the 5 years before Barack Obama got nominated for president, from 2003 to 2008, we had eight different times that bills were brought up in the Congress to remove the clause natural born citizen out of the eligibility requirements and to put in things like saying, well, they had to be an American citizen for 35 years or an American citizen for 20 years, but they just wanted to strike that out. Why would they want to do that? And what do you think it means?
Well, what it means is they want to make everything a lot more loosey-goosey than has been in the past. Mm-hmm. They want to create conditions that will deteriorate our political system. I do believe that natural-born citizen is going to have to be put to bed once and for all so that this doesn't come up time after time after time. Now, in my view, and I'm not a lawyer, just my personal view, I take a natural-born citizen to be the offspring of two citizens of the United States, or someone who is an offspring of an American citizen on American soil. I make the distinction because you might have someone born in Germany while a man is stationed in Germany for the United States Armed Forces, and his wife is there with him. And so I make those distinctions. Now, again, I get back to the point. This is going to have to be decided one way once and for all. I'm not much of an advocate of amending the Constitution of the United States, but we may need an amendment only for clarification of what that term means. We see the mass media over the last 200 years capture the semantics of our language, if you will. Mm-hmm. And they've been able to change the thinking of what certain words mean over a period of time, like inflation is a good example. The common welfare is another one. People have no idea what the original words meant.
Yeah. Or take and militia, so, for example. I had a salutatorian when there was an employee of mine at one point in time. He was a high school student. He was a salutatorian. And he was a smart kid. He'd learned everything they taught him in school. But what they were telling him in school was that the militia was the National Guard. And so we had a very long discussion about that, I can tell you.
Exactly.
So they can play that kind of game, and they can use that to completely destroy the meaning and the intent of the Constitution. I think we can go back and we can read sources that they were drawing from. We can look at the original debates. So we got a pretty good idea of why they had that there. And we understand that they wanted a continuity. And getting back to where we just began this with Heidi Cruz and her involvement with the North American Union, with the Council on Foreign Relations, with the Trilateral Commission that wants to create a unified United States of Europe as well as a North American Union, and then combine those two. We see that all in parallel with these trade agreements, and the John Birch Society has been on top of this. Thank you so much, Mr.
I got the horse right here, the name is Paul Revere, and here's a guy that says if the weather's clear, can do, can do.
Yeah, we've this got Brian Toohey. He's America's leading expert on fixing sports. Okay, we've got guys and dolls right there. And, of course, that horse he's betting on is Paul Revere. There's a lot of parallels to our election. and the fixing of sports. And Brian Toohey is America's leading expert on that. The Fix Is In is his website, thefixisin.net. Larceny Games, and he's also written this latest book, A Season in the Abyss, Sports Gambling Versus the NFL's Integrity. So joining us now is Brian Toohey. Welcome, Mr. Toohey.
Hi, how are you doing today, David?
Doing great. Now, it's interesting, you know, because when I look at election coverage, often it's somewhere between sports and weather, you know. we've got this real fluffy thing here. But at the nitty-gritty, at the very bottom of this, there's some real serious issues about how it can be fixed. And, of course, there's so much power. It's far more important, really, than it is when we're looking at gambling. There's a lot of money that can be made and corruption and fixing things and gambling. And, of course, we've had, I believe it was Major League Baseball was attacked once with the RICO statute, racketeering influenced and corrupt organizations. They came after him with that. So there's always been this type of thing floating around, but there's a lot more money, a lot more power in politics. But tell us a little bit about what's going on in sports in terms of the way that's fixed, and we'll draw some parallels to that.
Well, I think there's two different ways you can fix sporting events, and one way is the most traditional way that most people, I think about, and that's from a gambling perspective. And it's whether it's, you know, organized crime that gets to athletes or referees, or if it's gamblers themselves, or even the players or referees themselves who decide to fix a game or shave points. That's what's traditionally thought of, and that's what we've seen happen all over the world. You know, we've seen it in soccer, tennis, cricket, rugby. It's happened everywhere, supposedly, but here in our professional sports. Mm-hmm. But the other way I like to look at a potential fix is the league fixing their own games. And that's something a lot of people, and that's why I get labeled a conspiracy theorist for, that's what a lot of people don't necessarily consider is the fact that the leagues can use the same apparatus that organized crime is used to fix games. They could use those same things to fix their own games, and they have actually more control over their own games. And the fact of the matter is they have more to gain from fixing their own games, because that's how they make their money, is through fan interest and television ratings. And if they fix games to make them exciting, and I'm not saying every game is fixed, but just certain tweaks here and there to manipulate their own league, well, then they're going to make more profit, and it's going to benefit everybody involved, from the players, the coaches, the owners, everyone.
Wow, that's fascinating. I'd never thought about that. I mean, we always, as you point out, we always think about organized crime, leaning on people, or basically, you know, threatening them or incentivizing them to throw a game so that they can make a lot of money off the gambling. I had never really thought about the leagues fixing it for themselves to make it more entertaining. But of course, that's yet another parallel to politics. It's absolutely amazing. Tell us a little bit more about why you suspect that the leagues may be doing that.
Well, I mean, you can just look what happened in the past 24 hours in sports. I mean, Kobe Bryant retired, and sure enough, like Peyton Manning in this year's Super Bowl, he goes out on top. He scores 60 points on 50 shots, the most attempts made by an NBA player in something like 30 years, and he goes out the conquering hero in front of his hometown in L.A. And then you have, you know, the Golden State Warriors just won their 73rd game of the season, and that set an NBA record. And then you had the LA Rams, the new LA Rams, who just moved from St. Louis. They obtained the number one overall draft pick in this year's NFL draft with a trade through the Tennessee Titans, who know a thing or two about relocating. And it's just amazing how, you know, the leagues recognize they are entertainment. And the NFL even argued that in front of the Supreme Court. We are entertainment. So I don't understand why people get suspicious when I say, hey, these leagues are basically reality television. They even say they're the best reality television around.
Yeah.
And yet you don't think of them as being scripted or manipulated the way we know reality television is.
Yeah, it's interesting. So people don't really think of any of the sports as being rigged except for professional wrestling. But then they think, hey, all the rest of it is not just entertainment. It's not being influenced to make it more interesting. No, it's genuine. They're out there giving their utmost, and they don't really have any alternative motives. They can't be influenced by anybody else. It's very interesting.
Well, the scary thing is, I mean, I could be wrong in 99% of the things I'm talking about in terms of which games might have been manipulated or fixed. But the fact is, if the NBA just rigged one game, if the NFL just rigged one game of their own, well, that destroys their integrity. It doesn't matter if it happened 30 years ago or 3 days ago. If they just did that once, then you can't trust the leagues. And I think that's the same with, you know, we're talking a little bit about election rigging. Mm-hmm. You know, if just one vote has been changed by, you know, a Diebold machine from voting from candidate A to voting to candidate B, Well, then you have serious questions and you have a really big problem. And how can you trust anything that therefore will follow?
Yeah, you know, when we look at it, it's been a lot more blatant than that. And that's the most amazing thing about this election season. I was just saying, when we had four candidates in, I said, it's kind of like we had, if you had a sports analogy, when we were down to four candidates on the Republican side, it's almost like you had the final four, but only one of the teams has a winning record. And then the league and the referees come out and say, you know, we're going to change the rules and we're going to go to sudden death. We're going to forget everything. These four. First of all, we're going to let these three losing teams in the final four. And then we're going to, you know, not only throw out their record, but we're going to make it sudden death overtime. And we're going to change all the rules and we're going to fix it with our referees because we don't like that one winning team that's in there. I mean, that's really what we're looking at here, because long ago, they would have consolidated around somebody else if they weren't so opposed to Donald Trump and to his policies. But that kind of rigging, like we saw, the blatant rigging that we just saw in Colorado, where they just shut out the voters and even shut out the people who were coming in there to run as delegates. They said, no. What's your loyal? Oh, you're a Trump. No, you're not going to be allowed in. We're not going to put you on the ballot. We're going to remove you from the ballot. We're not even going to let you into the facility here. That's the kind of blatant, naked corruption that, boy, that would be it, wouldn't it, if we saw that with the NFL or the Major League Baseball, wouldn't it?
Oh, definitely. And I think, you know, the media plays a role in both. I mean, I think it plays a role in the political field, too, by not necessarily digging in to these, you know, election frauds and things like what just happened in Colorado. I don't think they dig deep enough. And it's the same with the sports media. I mean, I know from personal experience how big wigs like ESPN have shut out certain stories because they're a little too controversial. I mean, I wrote a story in my book, Larceny Games, about an FBI file related to members of the New York Knicks in the early 1980s rigging games as a favor to their cocaine dealer. And that was picked up by the New York Post. They put it on the back page of their Sunday paper. And it went viral, and it was everywhere. It was on Fox, it was on Yahoo, it was on everywhere except ESPN. And isn't it funny that ESPN gives the NBA over $1 billion a year to broadcast their games? So, I mean, you know, when you have situations like this, if the media doesn't do their job because they are in bed with either a candidate or with a sports league, then how can you even trust them?
Yeah. That truly is amazing. And that is one of the biggest parallels, the fact that they can control what is reported and that they don't report that. That's why this election, I believe, is such a groundbreaking issue. We've got a very vibrant and strong media that is beside the long-established mainstream media. So the information is getting out there, but they're not even trying to hide it. And I guess that's the most amazing thing to me, because they work very hard to create the illusion, and they always have in the past, to create the illusion that we have honest, fair, and open elections, just as they do in the sporting industry. And yet this time, the mask has truly come off. Talk to us a little bit about some of the gambling influences and scandals that have happened there. I know that's not your key thing about how they rig it, but talk to the people about some of the biggest scandals that we've had that have been exposed in the past.
Well, that's the funny thing is, if you look at professional sports in America, it's basically gambling scandals are non-existent. I mean, Major League Baseball says they haven't had one since the 1919 World Series and the mm-hmm. infamous Black Sox. Mm-hmm. The NBA claims they haven't had a game fix since 1954. The NHL says they haven't had a game fix since the 1940s. And the NFL, amazingly, is bold enough to say they've never had one fixed ever. And they can make these claims because, obviously, no one has been convicted of fixing games. But the fact of the matter is, I dug up hundreds, literally over 400 FBI files into investigations in the NBA, Major League Baseball, the NFL, college sports, and other sports as well. And the FBI had very, very credible information of games being fixed. It's just stuff that never made the public's view because, in part, the media really didn't do their job. And again, you look outside the United States and match fixing is rampant. I mean, it basically shut down the Chinese Baseball League. You know, we know soccer match fixing is going on. We know the corruption within FIFA, which has occurred. Mm-hmm. We know tennis matches have been fixed. I mean, we know it's everywhere. It's just American sports fans, I think, are very naive and very trusting, and they want to believe in the purity of sports, which I think in many ways people want to believe in the purity of our democracy and our electoral process, and yet they just won't recognize what's staring them in the face.
Yeah, the FIFA scandal was huge. And I'm going, you know, when we look at this and you talk about the fact they want to acknowledge that, we see movies made like Eight Men Out and things like that. But again, as you point out, they want people to think that that's somehow ancient history. That doesn't happen anymore. We've taken all these precautions so that won't happen. And we hear the same thing in the elections. You know, we're talking about, they used to talk about smoke-filled conventions and smoke-filled rooms and conventions. They now they talk about a brokered convention. I actually heard somebody on NPR say, well, they want to talk about a brokered convention, but those days are over. It's like, yeah, we don't have anybody using politics to get stuff that they want today, do we? I mean, that's absolutely amazing. But of course, that's NPR. And so the parallel there is that NPR, which is a government-financed news media, is basically going to tell you, no, no, it's all on the up and up. Just as you were pointing out, ESPN, which is financed by the sports teams, is going to tell you that sports is all on the up and up as well. Well, stay with us. When we come back, we're going to continue talking to Brian Toohey. His website is thefixisin.net. And he is an authority, an expert on how games are fixed, how sports are fixed. And it's all an illusion, folks. We need to understand where reality stops and where fantasy begins in politics and in sports. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Brian Toohey. His website is thefixisin.net. Brian is America's leading expert on game fixing and sports. We've been talking about many of the parallels to politics. Before I get back to Brian, I want to let you know real quickly, we've got BrainForce now at 25% off of our sale price. So that's a total of 45% off the retail value. Again, BrainForce at 45% off retail at InfoWarsLife.com. BrainForce uses natural brain activation ingredients like yerba mate extract and alpha GPC. Some ingredients in BrainForce are prescription in Europe. Take a look at the reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. We have hundreds of five-star reviews. You can read for yourself. People tell you what this product has done for them. And again, remember, it is 45% off retail, 25% off our sale price even. So this is an unprecedented special for BrainForce. You'll find that at InfoWarsLife.com while supplies last. Now, Brian, as we're looking at this and we're talking about the parallels to politics and sports, I'm reminded that there is a juncture there between sports and politics, and that, of course, is fantasy football. That's being that was actually a part of the debate. Jeb Bush brought that up, fantasy football. We've got an attorney general here in Texas, Ken Paxton, who is trying to regulate that. A lot of states are trying to regulate fantasy football. And yet you're talking about the fact that the real football that we're watching may, in fact, be fantasy to some degree. The league itself has an incentive to try to make the games more interesting, more competitive. It's not just organized crime coming in here and trying to take a cut, trying to throw the games. But talk to us a little bit about fantasy football, because that may be really what we're looking at, isn't it? But what about the real fantasy football?
Well, you know, with the fantasy football end of it, it's really what's become this daily fantasy sports where people can, you know, the original fantasy football was meant for a season-long thing with friends just getting together and, you know, maybe wagering a little bit of money involved in this. And then this daily fantasy thing sprouted up thanks to the 2006 Unlawful Internet Gambling Enforcement Act, which said that fantasy sports is basically a game of skill, not of chance. And that opened up this door where now you have FanDuel, you have DraftKings and these multi-million dollar, you know, prize pools based off of a single week in fantasy football or single game in fantasy basketball. And, you know, my research has shown that this is gambling. I mean, I can understand there is a skill involved, like there's a skill involved in poker and many other actual gambling endeavors. But when you have, you know, 100 people all throw in $10 and somebody walks away with the grand prize of all the money while the website keeps 10% of it, like the casino keeps a rake, well, then it's gambling. And mm-hmm. I think it should be regulated and looked at on the state level to ensure that everything's on the up and up. Because obviously, again, where there's big money, we always seem to find corruption.
That's right. And that's why it was part of the debate. It was really a dog whistle out there for some of the big Republican donors, especially Sheldon Adelson, who has always come in with tens of millions of dollars into these elections. And he is adamantly opposed to online gambling, trying to shut that down because he sees it as competition to his casinos. So, yeah, you know, it can be gambling and people can decide whether they want to legalize the gambling or not. But I agree with you. I do think that it is gambling. But that's why it is part of the political discussion, is because of the Republican donors who want to eliminate their competition in gambling. What's your take on what we're seeing going on in the election? Because it's not just Donald Trump. I mean, it's also Bernie Sanders. It's also the superdelegates and how they're rigging this. But we've never seen it as blatant, I think, as we have now with the Republican Party, where they're just basically pulling the curtain back and saying, yeah, we'll do whatever we wish. We're going to rig this however we wish.
Well, that's the scary part is, you know, you have people who are voting with what they believe. And, you know, people can say that's right, that's wrong. You should vote for this candidate, not that candidate. But when the fact of the matter is, when you have your vote and you think it counts for a delegate, for example, towards Donald Trump, and the Republican Party is coming out and saying, well, maybe it's not going to. We're going to spin it to somebody else, whoever we deem necessary. Well, then, you know, it makes you feel as a voter, does your vote count? And maybe that's the grand scheme thing that they're trying to do is trying to show you that maybe your vote doesn't count.
Yeah.
And maybe they do just really control everything. And that's, you know, as an American, that should be a really frightening situation. Whether you want Trump in or you don't want Trump in, the fact of the matter that this is occurring should make you really second guess everything.
And I think that may be part of the game. Maybe trying to get people so disillusioned with the system that they don't show up. Because I believe that if they have enough people show up, I believe that they can shave points just like they do in sporting events. They can shave points at the poll. They can shave points in terms of delegate selection and that sort of thing. They can stuff the ballot box, or they can manipulate the voting machines to shave points. But I think if you come in with an overwhelming number of people, they will pull back and try to rig the system at the next level instead of trying to do it in the election. So I think part of this exposure is to just discourage people from even showing up and voting. I think that's a real key part of this. Thank you so much for joining us, Brian Toohey. And, of course, his website is thefixisin.net. If you want to find out what's really going on in professional sports, is it really an honest game? We know politics isn't. Sports isn't either. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we were just talking to Brian Toohey, who is an expert on how sports are rigged. And people are starting to see openly how the election process is being rigged, and they're not happy about it. Now, today, there's going to be a massive anti-Trump protest planned in New York City. They may actually be protesting. There might actually be some Trump protesters protesting the GOP. There's going to be a New York State Republican Party gala event where Trump and many other GOP primaries candidates are scheduled to speak. This is a demonstration, though, that's being organized by many of the same groups involved in a protest against Trump in Chicago that drew thousands of people and led Trump to cancel his appearance there. This is going to be Occupy Wall Street protesters and 30 other progressive groups. So it sounds like it's going to be mainly anti-Trump and not necessarily anti-GOP. Our reporters are on the ground there in New York City. They're going to be joining Anthony Gucciardi in the fourth hour. We got Rob Dew and Joe Biggs there now. They're going to be talking to Anthony Gucciardi in the fourth hour. Of course, they'll be filing a report tonight about this protest and what's going to be happening there. It's going to be at the Grand Hyatt in New York. That's the GOP gala. That's at 109 East 42nd Street there in New York. If you want to go and see this from a distance, so many people there, you may want to just look at our report instead of getting directly involved in that. Now, after they do that, our reporters are going to be heading to Denver, Colorado, and there's going to be a protest there of the GOP by people who are angry about the fact that they shut down the election, that they disenfranchised the voters in Colorado. That demonstration is also going to be covered by our reporters, our InfoWars reporters. It is going to be at the west steps of the Colorado State Capitol building. That's 200 East Colfax Avenue in Denver. So if you're in the area, you need to show up there and tell the GOP that you're not going to be disenfranchised, that you're not going to have them select candidates, that there should be elections of these candidates. And this is not, folks, this is not just politics, okay? Because you're electing these delegates for one issue and one issue only. And what they're doing is they're making these delegates into double agents. And then even worse than that, when you had the delegate selection without an election, they put up delegates and they gave them 10 seconds. You probably saw the reports on the Drudge Report saying, hey, you know, I'm so-and-so, never Trump, or I'm so-and-so, let's make America great again. They would get 10 seconds to do that, and they would tell you their number, and then you go mark them. They had hundreds of people, maybe 1,000 people that were there running for 30 slots. That's an absurd process. The GOP ought to be ashamed of itself. It's a disenfranchised process. We had people report that, hey, they were not allowed on the ballot because they said they wanted to support Trump. They were blocked from getting in because they said they wanted to support Trump. It's a very dishonest process. And then on Saturday, After that protest in Denver, Colorado, again, that's the west steps of the Colorado State Capitol building. Our InfoWars reporters, Rob Dew and Joe Biggs, will be there. And then they will be heading to Portland, Oregon. And there's going to be another meeting there. They're going to attempt to have a meeting. Remember what happened the last time this happened? We had some Portland State University students, and we're getting ready to talk to them right now. Matt Duffy and Liam Nguyen, they organized Portland State students for Donald Trump. The last time they tried this, it turned into total chaos as we had the leftists come in and shut down their free speech. Now, this meeting is going to happen on the Portland State University. It's going to be Saturday, April 16th, 2 p.m. It's going to be the Smith Memorial Student Union there on Southwest Broadway in Portland, Oregon. And joining us now are Matt Duffy and Liam Nguyen. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
How's it going?
It must be a crazy thing to be in a university today. There's not any respect for free speech. And certainly it looks like Donald Trump deliberately, I think, he's pushing back very hard against this political correctness that's being used to censor people. And Donald Trump seems to have hit all their triggers, hasn't he, to use their phraseology. Tell us about the last event that you had there and tell us what's coming up this Saturday.
Well, our last event, at the beginning, there was about 10 or 11 of us who sat down at the table just to talk about Trump, talk about him and his platforms. And then we were immediately surrounded by over 100 Black Lives Matter people, people who want totally open borders, people who obviously hate white people.
Yeah.
So we were initially just surrounded by all of them. And then they openly said, we are taking this over now. They said, we're shutting this down, taking it over. So then every time we tried to speak, we were immediately shouted down, yelled at, screamed. I would whisper something to Liam, who was sitting there beside me, and I would immediately be hit in the back and told to shut up. So we couldn't talk. We couldn't do anything. So we moved, our group kind of moved to another part of the room where we were followed again by the massive horde of people. And then they started pushing me and Liam. They started getting physical with us, and then Liam's hat was stolen and then thrown across the room. So that's the tolerant left right there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's absolutely amazing. Yeah. And people my age, I remember when I was in college, we had the communists, we had the Black Student Union, and they would take over student government. They would get our student activity fees. They would use it to fund their own personal activities. They had a bit of a scandal on our campus because they took the money and used it for their own personal phone calls, but of course nothing ever happened to them. We saw that kind of corruption, which, you know, was what we expected to see with the real government when we got out. So yeah, it was student government. They were practicing what they were going to do when they graduated and got involved in the real government. But now it's become something completely different. We've got this article today, university singling out white students for education sessions, and they're sending them to a class called The Privilege of Whiteness. And listen to the advertising thing. Now, this is coming out of University of Wisconsin-Madison. Deconstructing whiteness is intended to answer questions that white students might have about their race, such as, why do I have to feel guilty about being white? Well, you should feel guilty, okay? How can I talk about race as a white person? Or what does it mean to be white? You get a lot of this kind of stuff today in what passes for a liberal education. I mean, liberal education used to mean that it freed you up. It gave you the tools of learning so that you could educate yourself through the rest of your life. But now it means an agenda, doesn't it, gentlemen?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Well, you know, I find it kind of funny that this sort of, you know, whiteness thing, they're attempting to explain my race. You know, you have these minorities explaining what it means for me to be white. And they say, well, you've got privilege as a white person. It's like, well, my ancestors were Irish. And if there's one group of people who really know what it's like to be oppressed, it's the Irish. I mean, their history is 800 years of English colonial occupation. And, you know, I'm not asking for reparations from the British Empire or anything. So I think it's just a load of garbage.
And then they had it pretty rough when they first came here as immigrants. Every group did when they came here as immigrants. But we once had a thing called the melting pot. Now we're told that the melting pot, this is another article we have on Infowars.com, saying that America is a melting pot is a microaggression. And this is coming out of Purdue University, you know, because we can't have a melting pot where everybody just comes together and makes something that's different, that's better than we were individually. You know, first they talked about the melting pot is gone, and now we've got a tossed salad where all the ingredients remain very distinct and everything. No, what they're really trying to do is set up something more like a bento box where you've got everything walled off. All the different ingredients are here. Nobody mixes with each other. They all stay in their separate ghettos. That is a prescription for violence and division in a country. And that's precisely what I believe they're trying to do in the universities and with our immigration policies.
Exactly. And if you criticize it at all, you get deemed a racist immediately.
Yeah.
Which is us absolutely insane. And that's kind of the entire left agenda kind of relies on people on the right being afraid of being called a racist. And with Trump supporters, that doesn't affect us. It bounces right off of us. It does nothing. And that's why they get so mad, because they scream racist at us and it does nothing. We don't roll over. We don't bow down. We don't apologize for being white, apologize for being a man. It doesn't happen. And that's why they get so mad. I think they could really care less about Donald Trump. They just want us to be under their control and bow down to them. Yes. They don't really hate Donald Trump. It's the fact that they hate us, and the fact that we don't bow down to them when they scream racist at us.
Absolutely. What we're seeing, this anger, this hatred that I'm seeing from the left when I covered this in Washington, D.C., as you pointed out, he's directly confronted their tool of social control, which is political correctness. He directly confronted it. So he's become a proxy over this war of whether or not we're going to have political correctness, whether or not they're going to be able to use this to essentially this kind of cultural Marxism. They used to break everybody down by classes, say the class that you're born into is deterministic. Now they want to tell everybody the race that you're born into is deterministic. When I look at this story that we've got about melting pot being a microaggression, they actually say the phrases of melting pot are actually problematical because they promote the myth of meritocracy. See, the whole idea of America has been a meritocracy, where we should create a system where anybody with hard work can get ahead. But they want to tell you, no, that's a myth. You can't ever do that because race is going to keep you down, or your social class is going to keep you down. That's what they're trying to feed everybody.
Well, I find it pretty amazing that the left, I mean, they're so much into the whole diversity thing. The microaggression thing, that it's gotten to the point now where they practically want Jim Crow laws now. It's like, oh, you see, white people are problematic, so we got to keep them separate. And I mean, who would have thought that, the melting pot is a bad thing? Like, who would have thought that, they're promoting diversity and then they're turning around and saying, well, diversity is triggering, basically. I mean, I find that very strange, but that's something only liberal logic is capable of.
Yeah, exactly. They're using it not only as a tool of social control, but now they're actually pushing for a kind of neo-segregationism, aren't they? They're actually saying that, you need to be, we're going to take the Jim Crow laws and we're going to apply them now to white people is really what they're trying to say. They don't want people to get along. They say that talking about being colorblind is a bad thing. It indicates if you're talking about being colorblind and not paying attention to whether somebody is a black or white, they say that a white person doesn't want to or doesn't need to acknowledge race when you do that. So they're actually promoting racism, aren't they?
Yeah, I know.
Oh, yeah.
The entire left says that the right is racist when they are actually incredibly racist against white people. So, yeah. The entire left is just one giant contradiction, basically. So,
all right. So now you're going to have this meeting. It's going to be on Saturday. Our reporters are going to be coming to that again. That's Saturday at 2 p.m. at the Smith Memorial Student Union. Tell us a little bit about what you're trying to accomplish on campus by having a Students for Donald Trump organization and a meetup there with Facebook as well as in person.
Well, I mean, there's really no better spot to gather for Trump than Portland. It is a liberal enclave within Oregon. I mean, a lot of places, especially Eastern Oregon, a lot of places outside Portland is pretty conservative. But because Portland has, the highest population density throughout the state, they kind of get to dictate what happens all throughout the entire state. So, on Portland campus, gathering for Trump is going to be, it's almost unprecedented almost. So we're standing up for free speech, obviously, because what happened last time, they shut down free speech. We're gathering for Trump because nothing like this has really happened on a liberal campus. And Portland is probably one of the most liberal campuses. So We're just going to be triggering a lot of people too, and breaking out this idea of, you know, political correctness. So it's going
to
be good.
Well, my hat's off to both of you, because you really have gone to the epicenter, to the heart of the beast, and exactly. You're not going to be intimidated by these people. They intimidated and shut down the meeting once, so you're going to keep doing this as long as you can, because you are now the ultimate minority. You know, you're
a couple
of guys who support Trump here at Portland. I know that we were there on a vacation. We're passing through Oregon. We stopped in Portland. We wanted to look at a hotel now. It used to be a classic elementary school, a very interesting building architecturally. We went by there, and as we're walking through the place, now a hotel and a restaurant, I heard this meeting going on where they were talking about all of these racial issues, very, very racist meeting, all the things that we're talking about here. I absolutely couldn't believe it. I heard that coming out of the room, and I stopped and just went in and listened for a while. And of course, everybody in there was white, and they were all complaining about white people. And that's what we continue to see here so much. I mean, this is self-loathing liberals here on parade. But this is happening at all the universities. As I just pointed out, I read stuff from Wisconsin. I read stuff from Purdue University. But I can imagine that Portland is the epicenter of this. And I really do appreciate you guys standing up for your free speech there. We all have to stand up for free speech. It's very important. That's why we're going to be there. We're going to be covering it on Saturday. I also see that you had something here about the BLM, talking about the issues that were going on in Portland as well. We've been there talking to people in the logging industry as well as the ranchers as to what's happening. Yeah, against Black Lives Matter terrorists. Okay. When I see BLM, I don't think Black Lives Matter. And when I see BLM terrorists, I'm thinking of the Bureau of Land Management. Okay, so you're talking about the other BLM, the other BLM terrorists, the Black Lives Matter people. Talk about them. Yeah, go ahead. You want to say about the Black Lives Matter terrorists? Were they there at the meeting as well?
Yeah, that was kind of the main group who came in on our first meeting. So. Yeah, who obviously they want totally a lot of people who are holding signs that said no borders. So they want totally open borders. So I asked them, I said, so you're okay with ISIS just coming in and just wreaking havoc? They said, well, we have to do it for diversity. And I said, that's treason. But what you're saying, that's absolutely treasonous. Just letting ISIS into the country. I mean, come on.
Yeah, you should ask them what they think about the drug cartels chopping people's heads off and hanging the corpses from bridges and that sort of thing.
Yeah. I mean,
we shouldn't vet that for anybody coming in.
And go ahead, Liam.
Oh, I was just going to say, you know, I find it very fascinating that these people, they'll say open borders, but they're only for white countries. White or predominantly white countries. They don't care that Japan took in a grand total of 27 refugees. They don't care that Saudi Arabia took in a grand total of zero refugees or Israel took in zero. They don't care that Turkey has been reported to gun down boats of Syrian refugees. They don't care about this stuff.
That's right.
But then when Donald Trump has the audacity to say, hey, we should enforce our border, I mean, that's just racist. And I mean, how dare him? He's just a terrible person, apparently, for wanting to enforce the law.
Well, exactly. It's a double standard on everything that they do, isn't it? Whether it's racism or whether it's saying that we shouldn't have any control over our borders or our country, and yet not having those same standards, as you pointed out, for Saudi Arabia, that won't take in anybody. And, of course, Donald Trump has pointed that out many times. That, hey, they got a huge country. They can afford to bring in. They set up all these tents with air conditioning for when they have when they all travel to Saudi Arabia, the pilgrimage. I can't remember what it is, but yeah, the Hajj, something like that. Well, anyway, the meeting is going to be on Saturday, and that is at Portland, the Smith Memorial Student Union. Thank you for joining us, Matt Duffy and Liam Nguyen. Thank you so much for standing up for your rights, because when you stand up for your rights, you're standing up for ours as well. Thank you so much. We'll be right back, folks. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In this last segment, Anthony Gucciardi is going to be joining us to host the fourth hour. We're also going to have our reporters who are in New York will be joining us as well. They'll be talking to Anthony Gucciardi. There's going to be a big demonstration tonight. Tonight, there's going to be a massive anti-Trump protest in New York City. They just had 27,000 New Yorkers come out to see Bernie Sanders, and they are expecting they're going to have tens of thousands of people perhaps showing up to protest Trump, specifically the GOP Less specifically, this is a New York State Republican Party gala event that is going to be at the Grand Hyatt in New York. It's 109 East 42nd Street. That's going to be starting at 6:30 Eastern Standard Time, I believe, 6:30 p.m. And our reporters are going to be covering that. And again, they're going to be talking to Anthony Gucciardi about what is happening at the moment in the fourth hour. I imagine as large as this protest is going to be, they probably already got some Occupy Wall Street protesters, other groups that are showing up there. These are the same people who organized the rally in, let's see, where was it? Chicago. Shut down that Chicago rally. The one that Ted Cruz put all the blame on Donald Trump. It's not Occupy Wall Street. It's not the George Soros people. It's Donald Trump who's to blame. And, of course, Donald Trump is to blame for these people vandalizing cars in the parking lot and other things that we saw. Many of the police who were trying to keep order there come out afterwards and say, you know what, you need to understand who the real villains are here. But, of course, everything for political gain for Ted Cruz, throwing not only the protesters there, calling them henchmen, saying that Donald Trump is constantly inciting violence. So today, this is going to be Donald Trump's fault if there's anything in New York City. Our reporters will be there starting at 6:30. They're going to be in Denver, Colorado tomorrow. And, of course, Donald Trump has tweeted about that as well. He says, hey, the rules did change in Colorado shortly after I entered the race in June because the polls, the politicians, and their bosses knew I would win with the voters. So just shut the voters out. And if you're going to have people run with this ridiculous idea of an election where they have literally 1,000 people on the ballot just represented by numbers, they give them 10 seconds to get up and introduce themselves and say, vote for me, I'm number 637, I like Trump, or I like Cruz, or I hate Trump, or this or that, and then shut that down and then don't even get that accurate. They had people that were double listed, people that were omitted. I mean, it was total chaos, total tyranny. They rigged this system openly to say, we don't want to have anything to do with Donald Trump. And as the New York Times point out, this was set up. You don't like these rules? Hey, they set these rules up to make sure somebody like Trump, somebody like Sanders couldn't get in. That's precisely the point. And it's okay. You shouldn't feel bad about this, says the New York Times. Just embrace it. Embrace the corruption. Learn to live with it. You know what you need to do? Don't let them discourage you from participating in the process. Show up at this demonstration. It's going to be tomorrow in Denver, Colorado, the west steps of the Colorado State Capitol Building, 200 East Colfax Avenue in Denver. That's where the protest is going to be. Show up at the protest. Tell them you're not going to put up with this corruption. And if you're in a state that still hasn't voted, show up in massive numbers where they can't shave the votes, where they can't stuff the ballots enough to keep you out of there. That's the way you shut this thing down. Shove it down their throat. Don't let them discourage you. Don't let them take it back from them. Take the corruption back from them. And again, we just had joining us in the previous segment, Matt Duffy and Liam Nguyen. They are Portland State students for Donald Trump. Again, they were intimidated. They were shut down. They're not going to let that stand. They're going to have another meeting, and we're going to be there to cover it. So our reporters are going to be in Portland on Saturday at 2 p.m. There's a meeting there at the Smith Memorial Student Union. So you might even want to show up there even if you're not a student, because they're going to have student agitators showing up. That's it for today's broadcast. I'm going to be with you in the next 5 minutes. I've got something else I want to talk about, why libertarians should reject Ted Cruz, because I get a lot of people talking to me about that. And remember, we have 25% off even the sale price for BrainForce at InfoWarsLife.com. That's 45% off retail right now at InfoWarsLife.com. BrainForce, 45% off retail. Stay with us. I'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. The last 3 hours, Anthony Gucciardi is going to be doing the remainder of this fourth hour. Before we go to Anthony Gucciardi, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the issues of why I think libertarians should reject Ted Cruz. This is an article from Eric Peters. It's up on InfoWars.com. And Eric Peters, I see, has EricPetersAutos.com. I think Eric and I would have a lot to talk about. He likes libertarian politics and cars. He has car reviews as well. But this is his libertarian politics stuff here. I bet he hates self-driving cars like me, too, if he likes to drive cars. He says, Cruz is a Bush neocon who is trying to hijack the conservative and the libertarian movements. Yes, absolutely. And listen to what he has to say. Now that the other front men for the irremediably corrupt GOP establishment have been trumped, all hope is pinned on the former Bush machine operative who's touted as an outsider that will rescue our freedoms from the grasping talons of the dread Hildebeest. In other words, you got to support Ted Cruz or we'll get Hillary Clinton. It's like, really? Well, you know what? There are some policies that they always hold out there that they say, well, this is very different. I mean, you know, here's what the Democrats think about abortion. Here's what we think about abortion. And then they offer you a strategy to say, well, we're going to appoint some Supreme Court justices who presumably will overturn Roe v. Wade. And it's like, and if you look at Ted Cruz's site, where he talks about protecting the Constitution, all he does is talk about his many different cases that he's argued before the Supreme Court. That's not the only way we protect the Constitution, folks. And you need to understand, they've been gaming you with this for a very long time, selling you a bill of goods saying, we're going to get rid of Obamacare. We're going to get rid of the open borders and so on and so forth. And saying, oh, I can't do anything about Obamacare now because of the Supreme Court. Look, it's criminal. And they have supported indirectly the executive orders of Obama. They have allowed the essentially the executive orders of these bureaucracies, they've allowed the bureaucracies to act as if there are governments. We not only have taxation without representation with the bureaucracies, but we also have legislation without representation. We have these bureaucratic courts bring you into the bureaucratic courts and they try you without the presumption of innocence. And then they assess excessive fines to you. We see that happening with the EPA, with many of these organizations. They have civil asset forfeiture. And he goes on to say, will the election of Ted Cruz mean that I and other peaceful Americans who've committed no crime, who've given no reason to suspect us of having committed one, will be able to fly without crotch groping? Will random, probable cause-free stop and searches on our roads be ended? Will they stop confiscating our property when they do that, calling it civil asset forfeiture? Will I no longer be presumed guilty until I prove myself innocent? Will I no longer be forced to send money to a health insurance mafia? Will the troops be called home and disbanded to civilian life? Will the government cease making war on individuals who choose to put certain substances into their body, cause no harm as such to any other person by doing so? Will the practice of monitoring and recording the private communications of individuals en masse, not even suspected of having committed a crime, be discontinued? See, the issue is, have you heard them talk about any of this in the debates? No, they don't talk about this. They don't even ask them questions about it. As a matter of fact, when they talk about Obamacare, they don't ask them what their plans are. Donald Trump put out a 7-point free market plan. Gives you choice, gives you competition, gives you information, gives you ownership, removes the mandate, replaces it with incentives. Do they talk about that? No. No, they don't talk about that. They want to talk about he and Megyn Kelly. Okay, that's the issue. And then you got Ted Cruz, who comes in and says, I'm Mr. Constitution, to appeal to the conservatives. He also puts himself out as a neocon. He was throwing the word around using it like a dog whistle, but then he appointed all these guys as his advisors, and believe me, he wants the wars everywhere. Then he comes in and he says, he's campaigning in Colorado, he says, no, I'll let you guys smoke pot. It was just 2 years ago that he was saying it was an abuse of the executive for Obama not to shut that down in Colorado because he just throws the Constitution around as he wishes. Stay with us. Anthony Gucciardi, be right back.
All right, it's overdrive time. I'm Anthony Gucciardi, and I'll be with you for the rest of the hour. The big news today is the protests in New York City, massive anti-Trump protests at the GOP gala, right? Some crazy things going on. We've got Rob Dew coming up at 2:30 live via Skype, and they've already set up some blockades, it looks like. He's got a report. We're going to play on that. Set up a, quote, Trump wall for protesters. And again, this is at the Grand Hyatt, New York, if you want to get involved, on 109 East 42nd Street, New York, New York, 10017 is the zip code. It starts at 6:30 p.m., so you've got some time to get over there. Let me tell you, if I was in around that area right now, I'd be heading over there. It's going to be some very interesting stuff. But if you can't get over there and you're anywhere else in the world, you'll be getting it from us because Rob Dew's out there, and we're going to talk to him live here at the bottom of the hour. So for starters, if you don't know what I'm talking about, massive anti-Trump protests planned in New York City Thursday evening. Organizers of these protests told Yahoo News they expect at least 10,000 people to show up for the protest. It's being held in front of the annual New York State Republican Party gala, where Trump and other GOP primary candidates are scheduled to speak. The demonstration is being organized by many of the same groups that were involved in the protest against Trump in Chicago that drew thousands and led the candidates to cancel one of his planned appearances. So what I want to do is I want to play this video here in a second about this Trump wall they're putting up for protesters, anti-Trump protesters in New York City by Rob Dew. First, I want to talk a little bit about the anti-Trump protesters. What's interesting to me, and look, there's been so many different videos, some of them quite hilarious, different meme videos and parody videos of the anti-Trump protesters, right? Many of them shot by Rob Dew and other InfoWars reporters and such. But what's interesting to me, okay, isn't that they're anti-Trump protesters. It's the sad reality of the debate that I see from both sides. So, for example, some of these videos, they ask the anti-Trump protesters, why are you here? Why are you against Trump? And they'll say something like, well, he's racist or he's sexist. And, okay, that'd be one thing. They ask, though, give examples on your statements. You know, do you are you against some of his policies? And look, I'm not a Trump fanatic at all. Not at all, okay? I could easily argue on different sides. I could argue for Trump or against Trump. I could say, you know, it's extreme that he wants to kill terrorist families. Or I could say, you know, look what he said on this issue, that issue, that issue, and bring up actual events, right? Or say, look at his, you know, previous record and look at it now, blah, blah, blah. But you ask these people, a lot of them, not all of them, not everyone against Trump. I'm saying that a lot of these protesters, though, it's very messed up. You say, well, what are you against policy-wise on Trump? They say, shut up. You're racist. F you, and like spit in people's faces. Okay. I don't know if they realize this, but it's making those people look very, very bad. Very, very bad. When you're having a professional camera set up with a reporter and asking, what do you think about this? Just spitting in their face. Screw you. You're racist. That's really not going to go down too well. And also calls for violence, calls for assassinations. It's just so over the top now. So I want to go to this video by Rob Dew about the Trump wall set up for protesters in New York City to get us prepared. Again, he's going to join us bottom of the hour live. Got a lot of interesting coverage today. Let's check out this video.
Rob Dew reporting for Infowars.com, and we're in the corner of Lexington Avenue and East 42nd Street in downtown Manhattan. Right behind me is the Grand Hyatt Hotel, where tonight will be the GOP of New York, their Republican gala. And as you can see, there's already protester barriers set up by the NYPD. They were setting these up last night, and they stretch, I don't know, basically about six blocks in either direction, because they are expecting a large number of protesters here tonight. There's a Facebook page out, one, Jews Against Trump. 1,400 protesters definitely saying they're going to come. Another 3,000 said they're interested in coming. But last night, there was a rally in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And I'm going to bring Joe Biggs over here. Joe, what happened last night in Pittsburgh?
Well, last night at a Trump rally in Pittsburgh, three were arrested, four officers were injured. Now, it says three people were arrested, four officers suffered injuries during a clash between Donald Trump supporters and protesters. Trump held a rally at the David L. Lawrence Convention Center Wednesday night. The mood outside the building was extremely tense. And like you said, there is a Facebook page up for this event today at the Hyatt. But think about this. How many people aren't on Facebook and how many people know about this? They're going to come out. That's just what we can expect, is around 1,400 people. But I guarantee you, in a place like this, a hotbed, there's going to be way more people. Today will be extremely tense, and it'll be something to keep an eye on to see how further rallies are going to happen throughout New York as he continues his campaign in New York.
Right. And then in Colorado, the protest site has changed. It's gone from the GOP headquarters to the Capitol in Denver. And Trump actually tweeted at least three tweets about the change right now. Biggest story in politics is now happening in the great state of Colorado, where over 1 million people have been precluded from voting. Here's the second one. The rules did change in Colorado shortly after I entered the race in June with the polls, and their bosses knew I would win with the voters. Big protest march in Colorado on Friday afternoon. Don't let the bosses take away your vote. We are going to be there tomorrow. It starts at 3 p.m. Central Time, or I guess 3 p.m. Mountain Time. That would be 4 p.m. Central Time. We will be there with the rest of the GOP that did not get to vote, the 1 million GOPers that were unable to vote in that primary or caucus, whatever. They definitely changed the rules on it after Donald Trump got in. And now, if you flashback, there's a flashback here to another story. This is also on Drudge. Colorado GOP chair on Donald Trump looking forward to Fiorina making Trump look bad. And he actually said, there's no way he's going to be the nominee. Absolutely not. So they definitely ensured it in their state that Trump will not be the nominee by basically setting up a system where only Ted Cruz could win. So there are going to be big protests there. We're expecting big protests here today. But now, Joe, what happened at Tulane University? There's more free speech under attack. Here's a group, a frat in Tulane. Let's see. Here we go. I'm going to bring this up.
Well, now I can't find it. It was on Daily Mail. It was talking about Tulane University, a frat in Tulane. They set up a wall every year for their pledge week. And then on the wall, somebody wrote, "Make America Great Again." And now they've told them, they've allegedly football players have taken it down. They've dismantled the wall. And they're being attacked basically for their free speech. They said it was a piece of satire that they did. What do you think about that, Joe Biggs?
I mean, that's ridiculous. I mean, if they're doing it for satire, you know, whatever, get over it. The fact is, though, freedom of speech is under attack. This stuff's just got to stop. It's ridiculous. Who cares if someone thinks differently than you? It's going to happen. That's what America is founded on. And yet you have all these people talking about what Americans should be. We should allow the borders to be open. We should allow everybody to come in. But they completely ignore the fact of another key part of being an American, and that's freedom of speech. We have to continue to fight. So come out of these protests. Come to Colorado. Come to Portland. It's important.
Travis, get a shot of this right here. Tulane University fraternity causes uproar after erecting Trump wall that reads "Make America Great Again." There's the wall. They say they do this every year as part of the local chapter's annual tradition. It builds a wall around its private property each spring ahead of its Old South formal ball. So they were getting ready to have a ball there, and they do this every year, and I guess some guys, you know, want to make America great again. So we can't have that in the land of the free, home of the brave, especially in Louisiana. That's in New Orleans, actually. Tulane University is in New Orleans. So we'll have more reports coming up throughout the day. We're going to be on the Alex Jones Show coming up with David Knight, and then again in the fourth hour. So stay tuned for that and more reports on the Alex Jones Channel and InfoWars.com. Rob Dew reporting for InfoWars.com. Back to you guys in the studio.
Well, there's that video by Rob Dew. You know, societies fall because they fail to understand and pay attention to the details. Our headline society, where everything is just black or white, A or B, you know, one side or the other side, is the road to total destruction. And what I mean by that is everything that's going on with the Trump, anti-Trump, just total chaos, is an exemplification of our lack of details as a society. You don't see someone like William F. Buckley. You don't see, you know, philosophers going up and pontificating about the anything, really. You know, it's kind of hard to find the words sometimes because they don't say anything anymore like that. But going on and talking about Trump's policies and specific points and specific points on Hillary and everything like that, it's now gone to, if you like Trump, you're a racist. If you don't like Hillary, you're a sexist because she's a woman and she needs to get in. And for me, that's absurd because I refuse to check any of the above. I refuse to align with something just because I can't understand the details of something. That's what is concerning about these anti-Trump protesters. And again, I'm not even sitting here pushing Trump. You can just watch these videos and they start talking about details with these people and they freak out. They hate it. They hate it. In these videos I've seen, there's so many of them. They just can't talk about the details. They want to label things because when you label something, you can control it and you can understand it. If you can't label something, you can't understand it or control it a lot of the times. So it's almost like we have descended into idiocracy on both sides because no longer is there intellectual discussion of things that actually matter on a big front. It's just so absurd. And what happens is we get sideswiped, you know, we get sideswiped away from these realities like corporations having $1.4 trillion hidden in tax havens. 20 of the biggest profitable U.S. companies paid no taxes. 1 in 5, according to CBS, don't even pay taxes. And I don't know about you, but I'm not very happy to write the IRS a big old check here this week. I'm not very happy about that, giving a large percentage of my income to the IRS, as companies like Merck, General Motors, Public Storage, Iron Mountain, there's a whole list here. A lot of these are shell-type companies you wouldn't really recognize. News Corp. All of these companies are making just billions and billions of dollars and paying 0% tax. Okay? But, you know, we can't talk about that. We have to talk about if somebody's a racist. Not allowed to talk about that kind of stuff. Anyway, we'll be back. Rob Dew's going to join us at the bottom of the hour live from New York City where the rallies are going on. Also, don't forget, on Friday, he's going to the Denver Stop the Steal protest. And on Saturday, the Portland State Students for Donald Trump meeting. So we'll talk more about that when we come back. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. This is the fourth hour. More to come. All right, lots of craziness going on. Coming up, we've got Rob Dew from New York City. He's outside with the anti-Trump protesters setting up. They've got a Trump wall going up because there's supposed to be 10,000 anti-Trump protesters at the New York GOP gala. So one more time, I'm going to give the address out if you're in the area, or just stick around and you'll check out the live coverage here. So it's Grand Hyatt, New York, 109 East 42nd Street, New York, New York, 10017 is the zip code. It's up on screen right now. Hey, if you're in the area, head over, take some videos, send them in. It starts at 6:30, but I think it's already heating up. And then also I want to let you know that Rob and Biggs, I would imagine as well, tomorrow on Friday are going to the Denver Stop the Steal protest. It's at 3 p.m., the west steps of the Colorado State Capitol Building, 200 East Colfax Avenue, Denver, Colorado, where, of course, there was no votes. The delegates all went to Ted Cruz. And the next day, Saturday, they're going to the Portland State Students for Donald Trump meeting, which I think they're going there because what happens is, you know, there's like five students that support Trump and like 50 people come out and start screaming at them, cursing at them. That's Saturday, April 16th at 2 p.m., at the Smith Memorial Student Union. That's a Pacific time, 2 p.m. Pacific. The Smith Memorial Student Union. So check that out. It's also up on screen. Take a screenshot. Check it out. Look it up. Head over there. Take some video. Now, also, before we go into this next video to highlight something that I think is just so crucial with everything that's going on, check out InfoWarsLife.com. Brain Force. I'm going to pull it out here. Brain Force is 45% off retail, 25% off the sale price. Most companies would not even distinguish that. They wouldn't say 45% off retail. They would just say 45% and probably sell more bottles. But instead, Alex doesn't want to do that. He knows he actually wants to show you the real price that's reduced by 25% off sale price, but that is 45% off retail. Total absurdity. So go to InfoWarsLife.com and get your Brain Force. David took it this morning. Rob Dew raves about it. I take it. I can tell the difference when I don't. Read the reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. This is the real deal. This has ingredients that are prescription in Europe. It has alpha GPC. It has so many different compounds and yerba mate. So instead of drinking a big old sugary yerba mate when you think it's healthy for you, take some Brain Force. Hyperzine A. Just look up the ingredients for yourself. Because, you know, I can't get into all the things they do because I don't want to make any claims and I don't want to give any healthcare advice. So check it out for yourself. InfoWarsLife.com. Trust me. If there's one product you feel right away, it's Brain Force. So give it a shot. It's 45% off retail. It's the real deal. Now, listen, once a society goes crazy, it seems that everyone goes crazy. And once the people at the top, as above, so below, start to lose their mind and call people names, it seems the news cycle just can't help itself. So I'm about to play this video. I've got almost no time left in the segment to play it, but it's important. We have to play this. Kruzenbeck, Trump is a sore loser. Listen to this, what's going on in the news now over a sore loser. There's no votes, doesn't matter. You're a sore loser. Let's play that video.
Donald is a very sore loser. He doesn't handle losing well, and he throws a fit. He is crying and screaming and yelling, and he insults people, and he curses at people, and he attacks people when he loses. He behaves like a child, as Anderson Cooper pointed out, like a five-year-old. And the simple reality is in the last 3 weeks, there have been 11 elections in four states across the country. And we have beaten Donald Trump in all 11 elections. Donald is panicking. He is scared. You know, Donald loves to call people a loser. Mm-hmm. Donald wakes up at night in cold sweats that people will call him losing Donald. That is his ultimate fear. And every time the voters reject him, and they've now done so in 11 elections, starting in Utah, 69% of the voters, we won a landslide there, got every one of the delegates. Then in North Dakota, very different state, they had their convention. They elected their delegates of the declared delegates. We won 18. Donald won one. Then Wisconsin. The media said Wisconsin was a perfect state for Donald Trump. They said Cruz could not win in Wisconsin. It's an upper Midwest state, industrial state, not a very large evangelical population. It was a blue-collar, working-class state. The day before the election, Glenn, Donald boldly predicted a, quote, big victory in Wisconsin. The next day, he didn't specify for whom.
He was right.
And the next day, he got shellacked. We won another landslide, 48% of the vote, beat him by 13 points. And then Colorado. You know, the temper tantrum that Donald is throwing over Colorado is really ridiculous because they didn't just have one election. They had eight elections in Colorado. They had one in each of the seven congressional districts. And then they had a statewide convention. I was at the convention. 6,000 people at the convention were packed in there and voted statewide. In the eight elections, Donald Trump lost all eight. They elected 34 delegates. We won all 34. Now,
and look, the reason I played that is to show you how much of a reality television show American politics has been. We'll be right back with Rob Dew. You know, George Strait's actually on tour again. It's supposed to be his last tour, I think, last time, but he's doing a few more shows. Anyway, all right, so we've got Rob Dew and Joe Biggs live via Skype, and they are out in New York City where there's a massive anti-Trump, purportedly massive, protest forming. It's supposed to be 10,000 people over at the New York GOP Gala Grand Hyatt New York. Now, first and foremost, send in any questions you've got to Twitter, to me at AS Gucciardi or Real Alex Jones, and we're going to see also about getting to some questions since we don't have enough time to take calls. And I wanted to get some of those questions on everything that's going on with the anti-Trump rallies, the anti-Trump protesters. Send them in. Send in your thoughts. We'll be checking them out throughout the show periodically here. Now, Biggs, before we get into all the craziness, give us a brief overview of what's going on right now.
Joe Biggs here with Infowars.com. Now, we're standing right outside of the Grand Hyatt Hotel. Now, this evening around 5:30 Eastern time, the Republican gala will begin. There will be people like Donald Trump, Ted Cruz, and John Kasich here speaking tonight. Now, the people who put this protest together actually called into one of the local news stations and said that there's going to be about 10,000 people. Now, on the Facebook page that they have, there's only 1,500 people who said they're coming, another, 4,000 who said they're interested in coming. But I figured there'd be a lot more people. And as you can see, we'll pan over. There's a lot of police that are out here already thus far. There's barricades set up on both sides of the street for a block around any direction of this area. We're also right beside Grand Central Terminal. So things have been heating up. Last night in Pittsburgh, there was, some issues with protesters outside of the Trump event. Some officers were hurt and some protesters as well. So we're expecting a much larger crowd here tonight. Things will tense up. Travis tonight is actually going to go down to Times Square, and he's going to be walking up with the protesters. That's where it's going to start. They're going to march into this area, and from there, we'll see what happens. It should be interesting. Rob Dew and I will be breaking down footage, putting up reports on YouTube as well, and sending out updates as they happen.
So we've got an article up on screen. Pull that back up for just 1 second. Three arrested, four officers injured during clash outside Trump rally. I want to ask you a question on this about what you think will happen today, if you think it will be a crazy anti-Trump rally with, cops getting trampled and stuff. But first, 1,000 people on a Facebook invite and a group invite or an event invite, you figure less than half of those people are actually going to go. And 4,000 interested in going doesn't mean anything. You know what I mean? If I have any experience running some stuff like that, I don't know. I don't know if there's really going to be 10,000 people. What do you think about that number? And also, where do you think this will be headed if there are a massive amount of people there?
Well, I mean, based off how the cops are responding to this, I think they're taking that 10,000 number pretty seriously. And like I said, this goes for a block around in any direction. These guys are set up. They've been out here all day getting these barricades put together. Down to my left, they're actually currently starting to put a lot more of them together that way. So they're expecting it. They're not taking that lightly. But things can get crazy. We're in an area with a lot of traffic. It could bleed over. People in Chicago are actually tweeting the protesters here that are organizing this event, saying that Chicago shut it down. Can you guys step it up and shut it down here? So there's a lot of animosity. There's a lot of people pushing each other, trying to hype them up to get them to see if they can do the same thing that happened in Chicago and deny people who want to come in here to this event or protesters that are for Trump, Cruz or Kasich from being in this area. So it's definitely, it's something that's going to be interesting. And if you actually get on the Facebook page and you look at the propaganda they're spreading, the things they're saying, it looks like it could intensify. So we'll be here, like I said, documenting this. It should be a very interesting tonight.
Absolutely. You know what's funny to me is you probably have way more experience with this than pretty much anyone else, going out interviewing the protesters and stuff. Obviously, I'm all about free speech. They should be there. If they don't like them, they should be there. Great. Awesome. Again, I'm not a huge Trump fanatic, okay? My issue is watching people interviewed when you ask them questions. We talked about this a little bit earlier. Asking them questions. What do you think about Donald Trump? Or even, what do you think about anything going on in the world? And a lot of these people, all they can say is, you're a racist, you're a sexist, scream at you and curse at you. And actually, you came back and told me the other day, this story you had. You were asking someone, and they just started cursing you out when you asked them specifics. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because anytime someone has a different view of something than you in today's world, they automatically label you as a racist. So it's like, oh, you don't think the same way as me? Well, you're automatically a racist, or you're a bigot, or, you know, you're transphobic, or you're homophobic, or something like that. One of these phobes, you know. So it's out of control, but that's what you're going to expect to see. And now you've got people coming out of this taxi with these Black Lives Matter signs. Look at these guys coming out in large numbers.
So it's really just getting started right now.
Yeah.
Well,
things are definitely. Do what?
No, go ahead, Joe.
No. But like you said, it's an interesting point. You know, anytime you actually interview somebody and you ask them, like, all right, so why do you think Donald Trump's racist? They can't really ever give you a reason other than, well, I saw it on the TV. The TV said so. Hey, there's a guy just walking by right now. What do you think about the presidential election coming up right now, man?
It's kind of interesting. The Donald Trump is kind of different than what they liked before he self-campaigned. He's not having any special interests. And he's looking from the people's side. And that's what I like about that. And other protesters, okay, it's a free, you protest. This is a free amendment. You can speech, but you cannot get the violence like burning out of my head.
So you're saying that as well. You're saying a lot of these.
Well, hey, your feed's cutting up a little bit, Joe. But, you know, I wanted to wait until those Black Lives Matter people got out of the taxi cab. Go ask them what they think about today. What are they here for? What are they protesting? You know, what's their deal? See what they're up to. You know, what's interesting also, like I've said before, if you want to say he's racist, great. Tell me why. You know, if you want to say anything, free speech, I love it. Just not cursing at people and spitting on them. Let's see if Joe can ask some of these people why they're at this.
So we're just trying to talk to people. I saw you guys getting out with all the signs. So what are you guys protesting today?
We're here to protest racist Trump and the fascist mobilization that has surrounded him across the country.
So what proof do you have that he's racist?
What proof do we have that he's racist? Every word out of his mouth, every word of garbage and dirt and insult. And this is really a people's movement from the grassroots that's going to say we're shutting down that message.
Do you believe in a peaceful protest? Or are you going to physically stop people from going in and violating the First Amendment rights?
This is a mobilization and a demonstration. What are you talking about?
Ask her if she could provide one specific example of a statement that would mean that would support her claims.
Down the message of Trump.
But you're going to be peaceful about it, right?
We're shutting down the message of Trump. We're shutting down the message of
Trump. So you don't believe in freedom of speech?
This has nothing to do with freedom of speech.
How not? If you're shutting down someone saying something.
And racist speech is not anything to do with free speech.
Well, where did you hear that it was racist at? Did you see it on the TV?
Constantly, nonstop. And everyone has heard it 100 times. So we don't even need to repeat some of the garbage out of his mouth.
All right, well, thank you.
Well, ask her. I'd like to see. And again, you know what's funny is I'd like to hear her statement. What did he specifically say that supported her claim that he is racist? What specific statement? If she could just name one, please. I would like intellectual debate.
Question for, if you don't mind, ma'am. You have one actual specific they just wanted to hear. We're actually live, so like, well, give me one specific time that he's actually been that way.
One statement. People are asking. Said. They don't want to provide a statement.
No.
So look, Joe, do you get this concept that people just want to label things? And I'm sitting here. Because I've talked to people like this. I've talked to them. There are reasons you can be against Trump, okay? I could sit down and provide reasons and things that he said and policies I don't agree with. I could do it. I could go to an anti-Trump rally and you could interview me and I could say, well, you know, I think he's extreme in the sense he wants to, you know, apparently kill terrorist families. I'm concerned about when he says, you know, such and such and such. But they don't say that. They just say he's racist. And it's not about Trump, guys. It could be anyone. If this was Ron Paul, it would be the same thing. If this was Bernie Sanders, you know, anything. You can't just say blanket statements. He is a racist, horrible, idiot, scum. You have to have at least something to back it up, right? I mean, you don't have to, right? You're welcome to be woefully ignorant. But it would be great. It would really make your side look a lot better. No matter what you're against, if you didn't just have to label everything. Do you see, Joe, how people... If they don't understand something, if they label it, they can have power over it. So, for example, if you're saying something to me that I may not agree with or may go against what my beliefs are, which we should constantly be updating and advancing, I can just label you as a Republican. And if I've been groomed my entire life in an echo chamber that Republicans are evil or Democrats are evil or whatever, I can label you something. And then that is supposed to just shut you down. Like everything you say is worthless.
All right. What are you going to call me if I say I love to eat GMOs?
You're just a bad person.
No, I'm a racist, remember?
You are a racist, yes. No, exactly.
That's what it is.
They can't, and there are smart people that are against Trump too, by the way.
But there's definitely a lot of childish arguments out here. Like you said, you know, if that's your only argument that, oh, he's racist, but you can't give me actual times he said something specifically. The fact that he's been in the public eye for mostly his entire life, and no one's ever called him that before, but now that he's running for president, now he's a racist. Now they want to disassociate with this guy. Now he's not a businessman. Now he's not professional. Now he's, you know, misogynist. He's sexist. He's Islamophobic. You know, he's only saying things that everyone's thinking. They're just too afraid to say it because they're a career politician, and they're more worried about hearts and minds and trying to win over your vote with a lie instead of being honest and telling the truth.
I mean, I want you to ask some more people too. If you can find anyone else interesting, let's get their opinions on this. If they think 10,000 people are going to come, I don't know if you can ask the police officers what they're expecting. Just anyone around that wants to give you their insight if they look like they're anti-Trump protesters. But what's also amazing to me is the shift that happens. Like you said, so Trump being a respected television person to a degree, a businessman, you know, a lot of the media outlets saying, oh, yes, Trump is so great, he's so interesting. And then as soon as he runs, you know, it's a flip around. But what's crazier is people are supporting politicians that speak like robots.
Exactly.
I mean, what's going on here? They go up like Ted Cruz, okay? Ted Cruz sometimes sounds like a robot, like a floppy disk is about to fall out of his backside. Like he's like just sitting up there like, Americans need to know that I'm here for, you know, it's just so fake and so cheesy. How do people possibly fall for this? Isn't it time that we at least just appreciate realness, just genuine people? If nothing else, Trump signifies that people are ready for a shift away from the establishment system. The American dream is dead. The American dream is dead. There's no question. Corporations have $1.4 trillion hidden in tax havens. No one cares. 20 profitable, big profitable U.S. companies paid no taxes. This is just 20 of them, like Merck and General Motors. CBS says one in five huge companies now doesn't pay taxes. So we're stuck to foot the bill. I don't know about you, Joe. I'm not happy about paying the IRS this week. I'm not happy about being told that anyone that makes money and anyone that's successful is bad and they have to pay more taxes because the big, huge mega corporations and banks that we pay $183 billion a year, by the way, the banks get that money from us, the taxpayers, because the bailouts were so friendly. We have to foot their bill. And then if we say anything against it, we're the bad people. So once again, everything is pushed on the people of the United States. The talking heads get up there and act like they're the saviors. We're not worried about the $1.4 trillion hidden in tax havens, General Electric paying no taxes. I know there's reasons for that. I get the whole minutia of it. But all these companies paying no taxes, Apple having $181 billion held offshore. No one cares about that, okay? It's that Donald Trump is racist. You're racist if you like him or if you even talk about him. I'm racist for even talking about Donald Trump. Not even saying I support him, just racist for talking about him. Do you see the horrible devolution, idiocracy level push down of the political system and the media system to where it is now a fifth grade level? Instead of talking about any of this stuff, it is just, you're racist, you're stupid, you're dumb. Why don't you ask some of these people about real stuff? Let's see if we can have one person have a real conversation.
Let's talk about this really quick, though.
Sure, go ahead.
The fact that they don't like Donald Trump because he's racist because he wants to build a wall, and yet these guys have a permit, and they're building a fence around their area where they're going to protest to keep us out, where we have a different opinion.
Hey, ask them what they think about their wall. I mean, they're building their own wall.
Why do you guys have a wall?
Is it racist to build walls?
They're corralling you into a free speech zone, you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah.
Ask him, you know.
Ask him what?
Why don't you just engage them and just say, hey, look, let's sit down and have an actual reasonable discussion. Just say, let's talk about some policy. Let's talk about what do you dislike about Trump's policies? Yeah. What specifically is backing up those statements?
Are you with them?
No, I'm not.
Okay. No, they said they're setting up right now. They said they'll talk
a little while.
Oh, I'm sure. Well, I'm sure you'll shoot a special report. Why don't you ask some people on the street what they think about this?
Hey, what do you think about what's going on out here? Oh, I saw you in the Philly.
Yeah, this is the East Coast. I had to come up so show support for the Donald. What do I think? I think if people knew what was going on, they wouldn't hate him so much. You know what I mean? The media hates him. The Republicans hate him. The Democrats hate him. To me, he must be doing something right. So I had to come up, show some support, do a little counter protest. I actually just converted somebody. They handed me a leaflet. I sat there, talked to them for a little while, and they said, you know what? I never thought of it that way. So
what was the conversation about?
The conversation was about he's a racist and
typical stuff.
I said, I could see nationalistic. And this day and age, I don't mind nationalistic. You need that. We're in trouble. $20 trillion in debt, man. You can't just wipe that clean. So whatever he could do, I'll take a shot. I'll take a shot with Trump over Hillary any day. You know what I mean?
So what do you think about 10,000 people supposedly coming out here today to protest Donald Trump? And when you actually engage in conversation, it's usually just the typical racist thing. I mean, how many people do you think are actually going to have intelligent conversations with you, responses? Just like Anthony said here on the show, that there's a we could come out about Trump and say you're bad. But every time you engage one of these Sanders people, it's always he's a racist, he's a misogynist, he's sexist, blah, 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 blah.
What are they? You know, they're getting their news from the cable TV, you know, if anything. If they're getting their news from anywhere, it's probably cable TV. And that's the talking point. That's the story. And if they don't have anything on you, that's what they throw at you, that you're a racist, because then you know what it is. Then you got to defend yourself against that instead of
promoting Trump. No, he's exactly right. By the way, that's a true East Coaster right there, and I can tell you that because I'm from the East Coast. The feed is just cutting out a little bit, Joe, so I was going to chat for a second here. But no, definitely, that guy hit a great point. He said they're just repeating talking points. And sadly, it's really, really sad. You could talk to people. Let's say you talk to someone there in New York City, and they say something like, you know, Trump, such and such racist, such and such abortion, and you'll go over to another state or whatever, and they'll repeat the same things. Unfortunately, some people, most people, it seems, have to repeat talking points, and they don't want to actually investigate because that takes mental capacity. It really, really does. And it's not just Trump. I get it. People are busy, but it really takes mental capacity to form your own opinions and look into things for yourself. And it's easier to shut down things just by using the same media tactics. But the reality is that the foundation is not there and the media is pretty much dying for a reason. All right, we'll be right back with some more from Joe Biggs wrapping up about what's going on over there in New York City, the anti-Trump protests, and much more. This is the Fourth Hour. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. Be right back. All right, we're back. This is the Alex Jones Show, Fourth Hour. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. We've got Rob Dew now live via Skype. We just talked to Joe Biggs over at the anti-Trump protests. It's really the New York GOP gala at the Grand Hyatt, New York. New York, New York. So before we go to Rob and get his take on all this, all the craziness, I wanted to remind you that BrainForce is now 45% off retail, 25% off the sale price at InfoWarsLife.com. BrainForce is the real deal. You will notice the effects, I'd say, within 15 to 20, 30 minutes of taking it. Rob takes it. He's actually one of the new spokespeople for it because he worked for 20 plus hours straight editing a video. Using BrainForce. So it is the real deal. It's 45% off retail, 25% off the sale price. Now is the time to stock up and check it out for yourself. Don't take my word for it. Look at the reviews. Hundreds of five-star reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Read about what it's done for people that use it and check it out for sure. Now, Rob, give us your take on everything going down. We talked to Joe. Lots of insanity. Lots of people that don't want to have real discussions about things. They want to label things. They want to call people racist. And, you know, the funny thing is, we're not even sitting here saying, you must vote for Trump. We're saying, well, why are you saying that? You know, why are you calling him racist? What are your thoughts on the issues? And it seems like they just want to scream and yell. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, it may get past screaming and yelling because we had a sign right here just before. You could see it in Spanish right there. It says Alto a Trump. There's also one in English that says Smash Trump. So they are... I don't know if that's a call to violence or not, but that definitely seems like something. I got a young man here stopped by another InfoWars fan. Why are you out here? Are you going to be out here for the protest?
I don't know. It's probably going to be pretty rowdy, but we'll see. I'm open tonight, so There was a Bernie rally here in New York City yesterday, and, you know, all the trendies were there, as Alex would say. So, yeah.
Who are you supporting in the primary?
Trump, yeah. Registered Republican, you know, make America great again. So TPP, NAFTA, GATT, the whole deal. I mean, I'm a regular listener. Thanks, Alex, for all you guys do. Appreciate you guys coming out here. And it's tough. I mean, I think Trump might win New York State, but you know, you come into the city, and I'm not sure how much support there is here. But people are afraid. I mean, you can't speak your mind anymore. It's First Amendment's under attack. So
yeah, we were at a bar last night, and Joe just had a Trump sticker on his phone, and it freaked out a couple people at the bar. And you know, we went out with the cameras and started, you know, arguing with them, which we'll be putting that up soon. It was pretty late last night, and we had to get a couple other videos up, and we didn't get in until midnight last night. So it was quite a scene here at a place called Rudy's Bar and Grill, and which was up that way. But what do you think this will be a violent or nonviolent protest tonight?
I mean, I just wonder how many pro-Trump people will be out here, because you know, I know upstate is a big area for him, but you know, from what I've seen, from what you guys have covered and you know, Fox News or whatever, unfortunately, you know, you just see the attack is coming from the other side. They seem to be the ones instigating. I mean, sure, you know, Trump said, oh, you know, I'll pay your legal bills, but I think that was more in jest, really. So, you know, First Amendment, I don't know. I don't know what to expect.
And it was a private event that people were getting kicked out of.
Right, yeah. So, you know, whether it's the air hangar, I mean, that guy had some links to ISIS over in Ohio or whatever.
Absolutely. So,
I don't know if that was legit, but...
So, yeah. Rob, where you have to wrap up here, so I want to get your final take on all of this before we go to break in about 50 seconds here. So anything you want to say before the end of the show?
I tell you what, stay tuned tonight. We're going to be posting videos on the Alex Jones channel. We may even go live on the Alex Jones channel, because the way things are looking now, it looks like it's going to be huge. Right now, you can't tell. I mean, a lot of these people are going to work or coming back from work, but these guys are gearing up. It looks like they have a lot of signs. Both sides of the street are blocked off, and it's at least a block and a half that way, a block and a half in all directions. So it's going to be crazy.
Right on. All right. Well, more coverage at Infowars.com. Alex will be back tomorrow, 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. Thanks for joining us. It's been a lot of fun hosting the show. See you guys next week, and check out Alex tomorrow, 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., and live coverage, Infowars.com. Today.